Well, happy hump day, everybody, and welcome to Saki Speakeasy Podcast. I'm your host, Saki Speaks. Thanks for giving me a slice of your most precious commodity, your time. I truly appreciate you. Y'all do me a favor and please show my moderator, Love Jones, a little love, please, and thank you. And also, please make sure that you like the video on your way in the door, that you drop down in the chat box and say, hey, girl, hey, and know you're going to like it over here. So go ahead and subscribe to the channel and make sure that you click that notification bell and select all so you don't miss out on a single chapter. Now, with that being said, welcome to all of my brand new sippers and speakers. I appreciate you subscribing and I hope that you find a reason to stick around. And welcome back to all of my wonderful returning sippers and speakers, as well as those of you catching this on the replay. Thanks for coming back one more time to love up on your girl. Because y'all know I'm trying to OD on the way that y'all love on me. All right. Listen, I'm early. Child, I swear. Here we go, child. I'm early. Yeah, I'm early. Because people was like, I'm trying to set my stuff. I'm trying to prepare. I'm trying to get ready. And then look, the main one ain't even over here. I was trying to get her a couple seconds farty button and fuck assing around and she still ain't here. But that's all right, because we rolling on, child. Hey, Love Jones, annoyingly wonderful little sister and moderator extraordinaire. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And let me see. First sipper and speaker through the dough. Irkin Jerk, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. And you too, Mommy. And you too, Shanae. And Naja. And Vanessa. And Lil Mama. And Danielle. Child, listen. Listen, Demisha done came in here. Wait a minute. Girl, listen. I done already told you, child. They be forgetting. They be taking a sabbatical and then coming back to finish the shit up and be done forgot, child. I don't know what to tell you. Take it up with her. Her name is Ambria Davis, child. Go on over there on Twitter and tell her what's up. Hey, Tiffany. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Lord, look who done came in the building. Hey, Foxy Woxy. Welcome, darling. Not driving and listening. Child, be careful. I'm so happy to see you here, girl. How you doing? I hope you're doing okay. Don't even answer, child. Just keep driving, okay? Just keep on driving. Don't worry about it. I know you're doing all right because you're here. I'm just happy. I got excited, child. Shit. But thank you, darling, for being here. All right. Let me see. Hey, Sierra Kelly. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Let me see. El Boogie is in the building, honey. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Wait a minute. Now I was... Oh, it's raining? Child, listen. Oh, no. We don't need no more rain, child. Mm-mm. I'm sick of that. Sick of it. Because every time it rained, yeah, y'all already know what's up. That's why we finna change now. Folks with this raggedy infrastructure but want to charge you a bazillion dollars a damn day for internet. No, God. All right, so let me get this time stamp so we can boogie on down the road. Because, child, I got to seeing how long you say. But maybe we'll be able to breeze through this shit because I'm really ready to finish, child. Wait a minute. I hope the baby ain't in the car with you, Foxy. You know how my mouth is, child. If the baby in the car with you, just put a little earmuffs on or something. Because you know my mouth is reckless, child. Oh, Lord. Mm-mm. All right. So let me get this time stamp. Oh, Lord have mercy, child. Oh, my God. All right. So let's... I got it. I got the timestamp. Trying not to burn my face off, y'all. Y'all know I loves me a good steaming cup of Joe, honey. And used to be I couldn't stand the mess. All right. Chapter 22, Shelley. Damn, we get to hear from this dummy again? I've been here for about 3 weeks looking and searching for Jayden, and still I came up with nothing. I couldn't believe that I traveled all the way down to Atlanta only for Jayden's ass not to be here. It would be just like him to put shit. I sat in the hotel room pondering my next move. I couldn't stay here much longer. I was tired and I was running out of money. Besides Jade, I didn't know anyone, and she wasn't answering the phone, which was beginning to aggravate the hell out of me. Any other time, I'd be able to get a hold of her, but not this time. I'd called her ass about 1,000 times and still got no answer. Fuck this shit, I thought, as I grabbed my keys and my purse and headed out of the room. I didn't know where I was actually going, but I knew I couldn't stay in this hotel room one more night. Just looking at these walls had me about to go crazy. I opened the door and headed straight for the elevator. After pushing the down button, I stood there and waited for a minute or two. Once I was in the elevator, I pushed the button for the first floor as the doors began to close, but someone's hand stopped them from closing completely. "Sorry about that," I heard a male voice say. I looked up from the floor, only for my eyes to be blessed by the most handsome man I'd ever seen. I mean, dude was fine as fuck. Standing at about 6'2" with a light complexion and a tight-ass body, dude looked like he belonged on the cover of GQ and shit. "That's okay," I said, flashing him a smile. I moved over to the corner a few feet away from him because I didn't trust myself. As fine as this dude was, I was liable to jump his bones and fuck the shit out of his ass right in this elevator. I was very glad when the elevator had finally come to a stop on the first floor because I honestly didn't believe that I would have been able to contain myself any longer. Good God. She act like she just got out the joint or something. Damn, girl, what was you gonna do? Rip his clothes off and drop on your knees? Good googly moogly. I almost busted my ass trying to get up out of there. That's how fast I was walking. Excuse me, the baritone voice said from behind me. When I turned around, I damn near went into shock. He was standing right there. Yes, I stuttered. This dude had completely taken my breath away. "I didn't get your name, beautiful," he said, staring at me with a pair of eyes that looked so dreamy I thought I was going to drop my panties right then and there. "My name is Lachelle, but everyone calls me Shell or Shelly," I replied, reaching my hand out for him to shake. "Kaylin, but everyone calls me Kay," he said, pulling me in for a hug. He shocked the hell out of me at first, but after a minute, I hugged him back. Okay, I replied. For a moment, we just stood there staring at one another. "Well, I should be going now. It was nice meeting you." "Likewise," he said, and I walked off. "Wait, do you have a man?" he asked. My mind quickly went to Jayden, but then I remembered that he was fucking around with some bitch, so technically I was indeed single. No, do you have a woman?" I asked. He smiled, and that's when I noticed that he had 2 dimples. "Nah, I'm single right now." "Oh, okay. Well, can I have your number, Ma?" Yeah, sure," I replied. He pulled his phone out of his back pocket and handed it to me. I grabbed it, programmed my number in, and gave it back to him. "What you doing later?" he asked. "Nothing, really. I'm really not from around here, so I don't know what there is to do," I said to him. "Why don't you let me take you out then?" he asked. I thought about it for a minute. Hell, I'd known dude all of 5 minutes, and here he was wanting to take me out. For all I knew, he could have been a killer or something. But then this little voice came into my head and said, "To hell with all that, this nigga is fine as all outdoors. What harm could he possibly do to you?" Sure, I replied. "Good then, come on," he said, as he began to walk off, motioning for me to follow behind him, and I did. I finally took a good long look at dude, and I figured out that actually, he was just average. He was like all of the rest of the dudes I was used to dating. He looked like a college boy. I needed a thug in my life. I followed him to the parking lot where he got into a black Yukon Denali. "So dude got a little money, I see," I thought, before I hopped in the truck behind him. "So where do you want to go?" he asked me, starting the car. "Don't matter. Surprise me," I said, letting my hair down. These past few weeks, I've been stressing about Jayden. It was time for me to let my hair down a little bit and enjoy myself. "Okay," he replied, pulling out of the parking lot. He then hopped on the freeway and headed downtown. "So, tell me a little bit about yourself," he said. "What do you want to know?" I asked him. "Whatever you feel free to tell me," he said, taking his eyes off the road to look at me. "Well, you already know my name. I'm 28 from West Virginia, and I have a son," I said, giving him only a few details. "What about you?" "Well, you already know my name. I'm 28 also. I'm from Louisiana, born and raised. I'm a club owner and I have 3 kids, 2 boys and a daughter, he said, keeping it short. Also, he a lie. He also got a fucking son with that other gal. What's that whore's name? Stacy. Nagging ass. Lord have mercy. All right, anyway. That figures, I thought. Once he said he had kids, there was no way a man this fine didn't have kids and a few baby mamas lying around somewhere. Where your baby mamas at? I'm not gonna get you in trouble, am I? I asked, looking over at him. I noticed his body stiffen and then his whole demeanor changed. Fuck me now. I knew damn well this nigga didn't have any baby mama drama lying in the cut somewhere because I for damn sure didn't have time for that shit. No baby mamas. I only had one, but she passed away, he said, sounding as if he was about to cry or something. Oh, I'm so sorry. I didn't know, or else I would have never said anything, I said, feeling like a total ass. Nah, it's cool. I just rarely talk about her nowadays, you know, he said, clearing his throat. From the way he was acting right now, I knew he had probably taken the shit pretty hard. Just trying to let her rest peacefully. Oh, okay, was all I could say. I was speechless. I couldn't imagine myself being in that type of situation. The rest of the ride was mainly quiet, with the exception of the radio playing and his phone that was constantly vibrating. We didn't say anything else to each other. Pause. How the fuck she talking about, he told me he just trying to let her rest in peace. I don't talk about her that often. Nowadays, now, like it was 10 or 15 years ago. Nigga, she just died a couple months ago, sir. Fuck is you talking about? Anyway, oh my God. To be honest, I wasn't even up for it anymore, but my mind quickly changed when he pulled up to this little soul food restaurant. As I said, I wasn't from around here and I'd never been here either. But from the smell outside, I was sure these people could cook their asses off. Look, Ma, I know what you're thinking and I'm cool, he said, shutting off the truck's engine. Let's just go inside and enjoy ourselves. It makes no sense to spoil each other's night. He didn't wait for me to reply. He got out of the truck and walked over to my side to open the door. Thanks, I said, and got out. Hey, Kay, the hostess said once we were inside. The way her eyes were beaming and how happy she had gotten, I could tell that either he was a regular, she was fucking him, or she used to fuck with him. What's up? What's her name? Matissa? It's M-T-I-S-A. Child, listen. Your guess is as good as mine. So how about we just call her Tisa? How are you? He asked, giving her a hug. I've been good. We haven't seen you in a long time, she said, hugging him back. Yeah, I've been busy. I don't get too much free time, you know. I feel you. Oh, hey, boo, she said, finally acknowledging my presence. Her eyes were so focused on him that I didn't think she had even seen me standing there. Hey, I replied dryly. I didn't notice her, and for her to even act the way she was acting was nothing but thirst. Well, come on. We have an available table right this way, she said, grabbing 2 menus off the podium. She then walked off, leading us over to a table to the left of the restaurant. It also happened to be a few tables away from the stage. Okay, now, here are the menus. Your waiter will be right with you guys in a minute. Have a great evening. You come here often? I asked him once she was gone. I mean, I used to, but not anymore, he said. Then his eyes got all sad again, and I assumed that he was thinking about his kid's mother again. Well, what's good here then? I asked, trying to change the mood. To be honest, everything, he said, flashing me a bright smile. And how would you know that? Don't tell me you done ate everything on this menu, Kay, I said, chuckling. Well, I won't tell you then, he replied. You mean to tell me that you've eaten everything on here? I asked, pointing to the menu that I had in my hand. Yes, you don't think I came over here all those times to eat the same thing, do you? Besides, I like trying new things, he replied with a serious face. And he then gave me a sexy look that said, I'd eat you too if you let me. I was about to reply, but the waitress came to take our orders. After getting both our drink and food orders, she pranced her happy ass right to the back to place them. Now, where was I? I asked him. Oh, yeah, I bet you like to eat, huh? I asked, flirting back. Sure do. Maybe you'll find out, he said, licking those thick, juicy, sexy lips of his. This nigga's a piece of trash and a killer, and you sitting up here fucking making googly eyes with him. Stupid. Oh, yeah? I asked, challenging him. Most definitely, he replied. Not too long after, the waitress returned with our food and drinks. Well, that shit gotta be raw, hell, unless y'all ordered fucking salads or something. Anyway, damn, that was fast, I said. Yeah, the service and food here are excellent, he replied, as he placed our orders on the table. Can I get you guys anything else? She asked. Nah, we cool. Thanks, though, Kay replied. She nodded her head, then left. From across the table, I watched as he closed his eyes and began saying grace. I was stunned. He didn't look like the type who was all into the Lord and whatnot. I closed my eyes so that he'd think I was doing the same thing. When he said amen, I repeated it right behind him. When I opened my eyes, he was staring at me. What? Why are you looking at me like that? Is something wrong or something? I asked shyly. I never liked it when someone just stared at me. Made me uncomfortable. No, I'm sorry. I was just admiring your beauty, he replied, looking embarrassed. Oh, well, thank you. Welcome, he said. And then everything between us fell silent. Well, let's eat then. That's a good idea. We wouldn't want our food getting cold now, would we? Anyway. All right. With that said, we began to eat. For the remainder of the night, nothing was said between us, but we were both lost in our own thoughts. The only thing that could be heard was the sound of our forks scraping against the plates. Child, listen, and there's a break in the chapter. Let me tell you something. If I'm sitting in a restaurant with you and we ain't talking, it's something fucking wrong. You gonna make my stomach hurt, and I ain't gonna be able to get through eating. That ain't gonna work. You gotta talk, hell. Fuck wrong with you, sitting there acting stupid. Anyway, all right, so the break is over. Man, he gonna end up choking a bug out of her ass too. Hey, Tracy J, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. And you too, sweet November. Hey, girl, hey, welcome. Let me see. Hey, Jewel Cray, welcome, darling. Thank you for coming back one more time. I appreciate you, darling. All right, let me see. All right, there we go. All right, let me get back at it. An hour and a half later, Kay tried to get me to go to the club, but I wasn't feeling that. I was too full and too tired to go anywhere, so he offered to drive me back to the hotel room, and I agreed. When we pulled up to the hotel, he got out of the truck to walk me to my room. I would admit the dude was doing everything so well that I didn't want to let him go. I asked him if he wanted to come inside the room. At first, he didn't answer, which kind of made me regret asking him. You don't have to come in if you don't want to, I said, walking inside. Nah, I want to, though, he said, walking inside behind me. I didn't know if it was my hormones or the fact that I had four drinks at the restaurant and the liquor was starting to mess with my mind. But the minute he closed the door, I went at him. I covered his mouth with mine, making sure to slip my tongue in his mouth. I wanted to fuck him so bad. I wanted him in the worst way. I went to pull his shirt over his head, but he stopped me. Mom, are you sure about this? I had to take a minute to think. I didn't know dude from a can of paint, but here I was ready to fuck him. Then that little voice crept into my head again. Bitch, get you some. This ain't nothing but a one-night stand, it said. That's when I made up my mind. Yes, I'm sure, I said to him. Okay, he said as he placed his lips on mine. He then picked me up and began walking over to the bed, never breaking the kiss. I thought for sure that he was about to lay me on the bed, but to my surprise, he laid down so that I was straddling him. I had on a dress with nothing underneath, so it was easy for him to reach under it and begin playing with my clit. I hissed as he rolled his thumb over my clitoris, which made me wet instantly. I bit down on my lip when he inserted two fingers in me. Oh, fuck. You like that? He asked as he slipped his fingers in and out of my pussy. Oh, yes. Lift up for me right quick, he said. I lifted up a bit as he began taking his clothes off, leaving only his boxers. When he was done, he took my dress and pulled it over my head. You ready? He asked. I was born ready, I replied, slipping my hand into his boxers. I found his dick and began giving him a hand job. We'll see, he said, as he pulled his dick out of his boxers. Let me see what that mouth feel like. Now, normally, I wouldn't even give a nigga head, but there was something about the way he said it that made my mouth water. Child, he could have spoken in a whole nother fucking language. I don't know you, nor where your dick has been. Fuck out of here, nigga. Shit, you ain't put no money on the wood. I'm already a dummy here fucking you for free, and you think I'm gonna suck your raggedy ass dick without putting a little money in my pocket? You got me fucked up. Lord have mercy. Anyway, sorry. She dumb as shit. Slowly, I kissed my way down his chest to his dick. When I made it to his dick, I swallowed hard as my pussy started jumping. Staring me straight in the face was one of the biggest and prettiest dicks that I'd ever come in contact with, and I planned on tasting every inch of it. Reaching for it, I kissed the head before inserting only a few inches in my mouth. I pulled back, sucking and flicking my tongue over the head. Mmm, he moaned, which boosted my confidence a little. Child, you was pretty fucking confident going down there in the first damn place. I wouldn't give a fuck if he moaned the fucking Star Spangled Banner. The fuck? Girl, you slow. Anyway, I made sure that my mouth was extra sloppy before I took him back into it. Hungrily, I started to suck his dick as if it were a lollipop and my life depended on it. His dick grew harder and stiffer by the minute, which let me know that he was about to let loose. I went in for the kill, taking his dick all the way to the back of my throat. I looked up to see that his eyes were shut tight. He grabbed my head and pumped in and out fast, but I could still keep up with his pace. With each thrust he threw, my jaws became tighter. A few pumps later, he released his seed to the back of my throat, and I licked my lips and swallowed every bit of it. Nasty, huzzy. Lord have mercy. Damn, ma, that was some good shit, he replied, lying flat on the bed. Before he could say another word, I had his dick back in my mouth. Once it was hard again, I crawled up his body. I know you ain't trying to tap out on me, I whispered into his ear. Never, he said, kissing me. Like before, he guided his finger inside of me. I'd rather something else be in me, I said in a sexy voice. You got that, he replied, as he removed his finger. He grabbed me by my waist and then guided himself inside me. Oh, my God, I said, as his dick filled me up. I had to take a minute to adjust to his size. Oh, fuck, he said, once he was fully inside, grabbing hold of my hips. You ready for this ride? I asked, looking into his eyes. Show me what you're working with, he said, and smacked my ass cheek. I stood on my toes and began giving him the ride of a lifetime. Up, down, side to side, I rode him like a porn star. I knew all the right tricks to pull when I wanted to make a nigga nut, and oh boy, was it a tease. I knew he was trying as hard as not to, but when I started rotating my hips while clenching my walls together around his dick, I had him coming within seconds. Child, that always works. You ain't doing nothing special. Any stripper could tell you that. Shit, they tell you that when they teaching you the pole dancing class. Or that's what I heard, sorry. Shit, I said, collapsing on top of him. I was tired and out of breath. You good, huh, ma? He asked as he tried to catch his breath. Yeah, I'm great, I replied. Well, good, because I'm just getting started, he said, rolling me over on my back. He placed his dick at my opening, and with one thrust, he was fully inside of me. We went at each other like two dogs in heat, fucking each other's brains out like there was no tomorrow. 2 hours later, we were both tired and exhausted, and we fell fast asleep. I knew for sure that in the morning, my pussy was going to be sore as hell, but I wasn't worried about that. It had been a long-ass time since I'd gotten a pounding like this, and I was feeling great. And that's the end of her dumbass chapter. See, like, this is the shit I was saying yesterday. What's the likelihood that you go all the way to Atlanta? And with all of the handsome, eligible, and some ineligible motherfuckers. What? Because you know they married me and be down. Like Luther Vandross. Creep, 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 creep. Yes, honey. Anyway, you two gonna run into each other. You two. The most unlikely two. The two that actually have shit in common. Y'all gonna run into each other. Okay, girl, you're doing too much, but okay. All right, let me get the next fucking timestamp, child. I see y'all with me. I don't know if y'all in agreement or in all, but yeah. Did I see anybody come in? Let me see, child. I spoke to Jewel. Let me see. Hey, Michi, welcome. Thank you for being here. Hey, Dior. Let me see. Who else, child? I think I got everybody else. Not making another baby, child. I hope not. Melly Mel is in the building. Hey, girl. Hey. Let me see. The twins is somewhere, right, because he got the kid. Wait, we don't know where them damn kids at. That's one of the questions we was asking yesterday, child. Right. Because remember, he ran off with the little boys. Yeah. So, I don't know. I hope so, Naja. That would be sweet if he did that. Child, listen. Chapter 23, Kaylin. I'd been free from Stacy and her father for about 3 weeks now. They only agreed to let me go if I'd give them the money. I thought about saying no, but then dude came in there saying he was going to hurt one of my kids, and I couldn't let that happen. This was my kids' lives on the line. I agreed to pay them and let the shit be. Besides, 350 G's wasn't going to hurt my pockets at all. I had way more money than that. That little chump change wasn't even going to break my pockets, but only had one problem. The money was back in Atlanta, and I was the only one who was going to be able to get it. At first, dude wasn't going for it, but after a while, he finally gave in, giving me exactly 3 weeks to hand over the money to him, or else he would hurt my kids. I spent 3 weeks in Atlanta because I had one of my homeboys place a tracking device on his car so that after I got my kids, I'd be able to go back and serve up some much-needed justice. I'd been staying in a hotel in Atlanta trying to stay off the police's radar. I needed a bit of fresh air, so I decided that I was going to go for a drive when I bumped into this fine-ass shorty getting on the elevator. I had a thing for dark-skinned chicks, and shorty was a cute chocolate little thing, but still she, as well as every other female I'd come in contact with, couldn't hold a candle to Mimi. Yeah, I knew that I shouldn't, but I found myself comparing chicks to Mimi all the time. I'd been doing that since we were young. Pause. But keeping your dick in your pants was something you still had a problem with, even though you compare all the other bitches to Mimi, but you kept fucking them, though. You kept fucking them, though. Okay, nigga. I see you one of them nigga-fied niggas. Okay, child. One of them new niggas. As I stood in the elevator, I couldn't help but to look at her. She had a cute face and a nice ass, which made my dick jump inside my pants. I hadn't had sex in I don't know how long, and all I knew was that I had to have her. When she walked out of the elevator, I went after her. At first, I thought she was going to shut me down, but she didn't. She agreed to go out with me. I took her to this nice place that served soul food. The whole time we were there, my phone was blowing up with messages from Stacy and her dumbass father. I didn't want to be bothered with them and those idle threats they were dishing out, so I powered my phone off. I knew that they weren't going to lay a hand on my kids because I had what they wanted. If they were stupid enough to fuck with my kids, not only would they not get the money, they'd also lose their lives in the process, so I wasn't worried about them. I decided to turn my attention to Shelly. At first, I thought she was going to be gullible and whatnot, but she actually turned out to be a cool-ass chick. I hated when the night ended, but I loved that she invited me back to her room. Shorty surprised the shit out of me when she started kissing all over me. Shit, I thought we were just coming here to chill. Well, I surely thought wrong, because the minute the door closed, Shorty was all over me. I wanted to make sure that she was sure about this, so I stopped her. When she said she wanted to, I went all in. I fucked her so good that I put Shorty in a deep, deep slumber. She ain't even hear or move when I got out of the bed last night. I had to search for my clothes in the dark, trying my hardest not to wake her up. When I did find my clothes, I hurried up and threw them on, then headed to my room down the hall. Once I got into my room, I plopped down on the bed, burying my face into my hands. I sat there thinking about everything that was going on in my life at the moment. I wanted so badly for things to just go back to the way they were when I didn't have any worries or anything. I just wanted the peace that I once had in my life, even though Mimi was no longer here. The way I saw it, the faster I got Stacy and her father out of my life, the better chance I had at getting my life back on track. Not wasting any time, I grabbed my suitcase from underneath the bed and started packing my shit. I needed to get back to New Orleans like yesterday, get my kids, and get the fuck away from all this bullshit. Before I knew it, I was through packing my shit. Called down to the hotel room. What? What are you calling down to the hotel room? You mean to the hotel lobby, but it says hotel room, child. I'm reading you what the fuck it say. And told them to send someone upstairs to help me with my bags. While I waited for whoever it was to come, I made sure that I had the bag that contained the money. A few minutes later, there was a knock at the door. Sir, I'm here to help you with your bags, he said, once I had opened the door. Oh, yeah, right this way, I said, leading him inside the room where the bags were sitting in the middle of the floor. He picked up as many bags as he could, then stood by the door and waited for me. Once I made sure that I'd gotten everything, I picked up the rest of my bags and we headed out the door, hopping straight onto the elevator. Once we made it to the first floor, I told dude to wait for me in front of the hotel while I ran to go get my truck. My truck wasn't parked that far, so it didn't take me long before I was pulling to the front of the hotel.
I got out, opened the back of the truck, and began loading the bags into it. Once I was finished, I gave the dude a tip, hopped in the truck, and was on my way. I was heading back today. But before I did that, I needed to drop by and check on an old friend. I knew I was probably going to regret this, but I needed her right now, so I threw my feelings to the side. When I pulled up to Jade's building, her parking spot was empty. Maybe her car is broken, I thought, as I got out of the car. Her apartment was in the front, and it didn't take me long at all to get there. When I got to the door, I knocked a few times and waited for her to answer. A few minutes went by, and she hadn't answered, so I knocked again. Oh, Lord. Sorry, y'all. My hand hit it and went too far. Is she not home? She hasn't been for a while now, a voice said from behind me. I turned to see her neighbor, Mr. Johnson, standing in his doorway. You know where she went? No, I didn't know she was even gone until Selena came by a few weeks ago for the rent and she didn't answer, he said, pulling from a cigarette. Well, if she comes back, tell her that I came looking for her. Okay, he said, and then went back inside of his house. I looked at Jade's door once more before I walked back over to my truck, got in, and pulled off. I couldn't worry about where she was. I had other things to worry about. My kids needed me, and it was time that I go and get them. And that's the end of his stupid-ass chat, the dumb motherfucker. I was hoping he would get fucking caught up mid-stroke. Shit. The fucking cops be sitting around fucking around with innocent folks and letting the goddamn criminals get away with fucking everything. Get your ass up and do your fucking job. Anyway. All right. Child, let me see. All right. Seem like all these folks keep on missing each other because they fucking stupid. All right, let me see. Did I miss anybody, child? Okay, I spoke to Melly Mel coming on down the line. Buck, who likes to fuck? Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. All right, so wait a minute. Erkenjerk said, but remember when he left the house after he thought he killed Mimi? He put $3 million in the bag. This is all over the place. Is that what he did? Oh, okay. Because I'm still wondering what happened to the envelopes of cash that Mimi had, right? Remember she had all them envelopes? She said she went to get back to get the envelopes. And then she, you know, while she was packing out of hand, that nigga probably took that money too. Because I know they ain't leave it there. And the cops damn sure ain't going to leave it there. You heard me? So what the hell? Anyway, let me be quiet. Sorry, y'all. I got to redo the damn timestamp because I started talking. But anyway, y'all already know how it go over here. Okay. All right. Y'all got about 5 seconds, child. And then we'll be going. Chapter 24, Jade. 3 weeks, three whole fucking weeks that I'd been in New Orleans, and still I'd come up with nothing. I was pissed off to the max. Hell, I was so fucking frustrated that I wanted to jump up out of the car and kill everyone in the truck that Mimi and her crew was driving. How could they be here 3 weeks and not know a damn thing? Shit, I'd gotten further than they had, and yet here they were on their way to do only God knows what now. Shit, I'd searched every address that I had gotten from the papers at Kaylin's place, and still I couldn't find him. I went all around the city, damn near stalking people to try to find his ass, but still I couldn't fucking find him. I was beginning to think that Mimi and them couldn't find them either. Why else wouldn't they be staying in New Orleans to find him? Pulling my phone out of my purse, I decided to call Shell since she had been calling me these last few weeks. The phone rang a few times before it went to voicemail. Stupid bitch, I thought before I hung up. A few minutes later, my phone started to ring. When I looked at the screen, I noticed that it was Shelly calling me back. What's up? I said, sorry, answering the phone. Where the hell have you been? Did you know I've been calling you for weeks now? I looked at the phone for a minute before putting it back to my ear. She knew I hated when people questioned me, and she was starting to aggravate me. I've been busy. What you want and what you talking about? You're in Atlanta now? I asked, changing the subject. Yes, I came down here to find my no good cheating ass baby daddy, but the nigga ain't even down here. Well, what are you gonna do now? I asked, not really caring about that. I already had problems of my own to deal with. Well, I was hoping that I could hang out with you since you live down here and all. Shell, I'm kind of busy right now, I said. Hello? Jade, are you still there? Look, I'm gonna need you to meet me. If you ain't here by the time that I get ready to go, I'm gonna leave you, I said to her. Okay, she replied. I told her where to meet me and then hung up the phone. I didn't know why her ass even came down here. I hoped that she didn't throw a monkey wrench into my plans or else I was gonna have to do her ass in too. Damn, this bitch will kill her sister too? She just a fucking serial killer, child. Lord have mercy. Unfucking believable. But that's the end of her chapter, child. It was a quick little skippity-pap. All right, let me see. Okay. All right, here we go. Did I do something here? Oh, no, I didn't. All right. Well, that surely didn't work. Why did it, Chapter 25, Shelley. When I woke up, it was almost daylight. I rolled over to see that Kaylin was no longer in the bed with me. I'd be lying if I said I wasn't feeling some type of way about the nigga leaving in the middle of the night without so much as a goodbye, because I was. I'd given that nigga some ass, and he straight played the shit out of me. That shit don't normally happen to me. Oh, well, fuck him, I thought as I got out of the bed and went to take a quick shower. When I was done, I started packing my clothes. I didn't want to, but I was about to head back to Virginia. I was almost finished when my phone chimed. When I picked it up, I noticed that I had missed a call from Jade. I looked at the time. It was only minutes ago, so I decided to call her right back. At first, I thought she wasn't going to answer the phone, but at the last minute, she did. When she answered, she sounded as if she was busy, but I didn't care. I was going to fit myself into whatever it was that she was doing. So when she told me to meet her, I damn near grew wings as I ran around the room collecting the rest of my things. I ain't even bothered to cut off the lights. I grabbed my bag and headed out. 2 minutes later, I was on the road to meet her. By that time, the sun had come out already. When I pulled up into the parking lot of the gas station, I didn't see her, so I called her phone. She answered on the first ring. Where are you? I asked. I'm parked at the back of the gas station in the black Altima, she said. I went to say something else, but she had hung up on me. Stupid bitch, I said as I rode to the back of the gas station. I spotted her car and pulled up on the side of it. Popping her trunk, she then indicated for me to get out. I grabbed my bags from the back seat, then got out. I walked to the back of the car and placed my bags inside the trunk before walking around the passenger side and getting in. What's up? I said, removing my glasses, but she didn't say anything. I then turned to her, but her vision was focused somewhere else. Yo, what's up with you? Shell, chill. Don't come over here with your bullshit now. Just sit your ass back in that seat and enjoy the ride, she yelled, not even looking my way. I wanted to chew her ass out, but I ain't have time for her bullshit right now. Chill out. Damn, I told her. She looked over at me before starting the car and pulling off. She drove to the front of the gas station where she sat to the side so she could see the highway. I wanted to ask her why she was just sitting there, but I knew for sure that we'd have some problems. I just sat there and kept my mouth shut while she did whatever the hell it was that she was doing. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, this bitch is crazy. I promise you. Oh, Lord, child. Hey, Ebony. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Hey, Shakara. Hey, girl. Hey, welcome. Now, backyard gang for life. Look at her. She like, well, fuck it then. Since I'm already in there, might as well just be out and proud. I'm a backyardie. Child, listen. Y'all a mess. But that's all right, though. Child, she said, in for a penny, in for a pound. Pass the red cups and the fucking chicken wings. Oh, Lord. Not the chicken wings, child. That sound good, though. But I don't want them fried. I want them baked. Real, 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 real good. I mean, the fried ones be great. Oh, absolutely. But I'm in the mood for some baked ones, child. Chapter 26, Mimi. When I saw the sign that said, Welcome to Georgia, I knew that things were indeed about to get real. There was no turning back now. I was going to get my kids back one way or another, but first we had to make a small detour. We were on our way to drop Kaylee and Kayla off by Margie's house. Jayden thought that it would be a good idea for the girls to get out of Louisiana in case anything were to happen. They'd be safe with her. No one would ever think to look for them there because they didn't know her like that. Only I did. Call Margie and tell her that we're almost there, Troy said. I'd been so lost in my thoughts that I didn't realize where we were. Okay, I replied softly. I reached for my phone that was plugged on the charger and then dialed her number, placing the phone to my ear as I nervously waited for her to reply. Hello, she said, answering the phone on the third ring. Hey, Margie, how are you? I'm great. What about you? How you doing? She replied, sounding like her normal, happy self. I'm doing okay, considering everything that's been going on, I answered, blowing air out in frustration. Child, we've had this conversation already, so don't you go getting all sad on me because things are going to get better real soon. Now, cheer up, why don't you? She replied. Now, where are the girls? I can't wait to meet them. Actually, that's why I was calling you. We're about to pull up in front of your house in a minute, I said, sitting up, trying to see exactly where we were. Oh, okay. I'm going to meet you guys outside, she said. And I had to laugh. Margie was a crazy little lady, but I was happy to know her because she'd give you the shirt off her back if you needed it. Okay, well, I'll see you in a minute, I said, hanging up the phone. A few minutes later, we were pulling up in the front of Margie's house. Like she said, she was waiting for us outside. Come on, girls, I said to Kaylee and Kayla. Pop the trunk for me, Jayden. Hey, Mimi, Margie said to me. Hey, Marge, I said, hugging her. I then turned to the girls who were looking on shyly as they stood behind me. Come here, y'all. Kaylee, Kayla, this is Margie, a friend of Mommy's. Margie, this is Kaylee and Kayla, I said, introducing them. They hesitated, but then walked over. Hey, y'all, I'm Margie, she said, stooping down to them. I'm a friend of your mother's. Come in, y'all, I said to them. Mommy's going away for a few days to get your brothers. While I'm gone, you all will be staying here with Margie. No, Mommy, don't leave us, Kayla said, hugging me tightly, followed by Kayla. I knew that they would probably act this way, but I needed them to understand that they needed to stay here. Come here, I said, hugging them. I then pulled back and looked them straight in their eyes. Mommy really needs y'all to stay here with Margie so that I can get Kaysen and Kaylin back safely. That way we can be a family again. There are some bad people out there who are trying to hurt Mommy, and they would do anything to get back at me, which includes hurting the both of you. I'm trying to keep y'all safe, but I can't do that if I take y'all with me. Margie will keep y'all safe until I get back, so please do this for Mommy and stay here with her. I knew they were only 8 years old, and it was hard for them to hear it, but I had to tell them the truth. I needed them to be safe, and Margie was the only way that they'd be safe and out of harm's way. But what if you don't come back this time, Mommy? Kayla asked me. Mommy will be fine, Kayla. I promise you that I'll be okay. Uncle Mark and Uncle Jay will protect Mommy. Margie will protect y'all while I'm gone. I'll be back to get y'all. In a couple of days, I answered her. My heart broke when I saw a few tears escape their eyes. You promise that you'll be back? She asked. I pinky promise, I said, reaching out my pinky to interlock with hers. Took her a few minutes, but she locked her pinky with mine. I hate when people say it took them a few minutes. It actually took a few seconds. So say seconds, not minutes, because that means she was just standing there. A few is three. She stood there for that fucking long? I don't think she stood there for that fucking long. Anyway, I'm just... No way. I then did the same thing with Kayla. I'll be back in a few days. Be good for Margie now. I love y'all. We love you too, Mommy, they said, hugging me again. They then let go and went to stand by Margie. I went to the truck and removed their suitcases. Thank you, Margie. I owe you big time for this. Child, you don't owe me anything, she said, taking the suitcases out of my hand. I then reached into my purse and pulled out an envelope filled with cash and tried giving it to her. Don't do this again. I'm not taking your money. Besides, I still have a lot left over from the last time. Are you sure? Positive. Now go on and get these babies and be safe, she said, giving me a hug. I will, I said, hugging her back. I'll make sure to send up a special prayer just for you tonight, she whispered in my ear when I pulled back. Thanks. I got a feeling I'm gonna need it, I replied. I took one last look at my girls before I headed back to the car. I love y'all, I said one last time before I got in the car and Jayden pulled off. Pause. You don't never pull off until your goddamn kids is safe and sound inside somebody's house. Stop dropping them off and pulling off and shit. Hell, what if they get blasted trying to walk on in? The fuck? Lord have mercy. Ugh, Lord, I cannot. That is so fucking crazy to me. Why would you do that? Anyway, child. Oh. Okay. Are you okay? He asked after we pulled off. No, I'm not okay, but I will be the minute all of this is over and I get my boys back, I said, wiping the tears from my eyes. We were headed back to New Orleans to finish what was started. It was time for me to put all of my emotions to the side and get ready to make a few bitches bleed. To me, it was wartime, and I was battling an ongoing war. I didn't start it, but I was damn sure about to finish it. There was no way that I was going to let Stacy, Kaylin, or Julius breathe another day, even if I had to die with them. And that's the end of her dumbass chapter, because she is... I mean, I get that she's supposed to be a mother determined, but the way she moving, like doing dumb shit about her mama, girl, fuck that whole ass junkie. Leave that bitch where she at. Hell, you could have dropped her ass off at the local yokel of fucking rehabs and gone on about your business, bro. Hell, fucking 3 weeks behind trying to wait for that fucking heroin addict to get her shit straight. No, God. Meanwhile, your baby's out here suffering through the universe knows what. Basket head bitch. Anyway. Child, who else was I supposed to speak to? Hey, Kaylin. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. Who else, child? Hey, Kay. Welcome. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you as well. And you too, Naomi. All right, child. Let me get on back with my damn timestamp. This I'm serious, child. Mimi did the dummy with that shit. It ain't no way for me to get past that. I'm sorry. Hell, I'm tired of showing bitches grace. Why they keep on sitting up here fucking doing the fucking dee-dee-dee dunce cap dance. Get your ass out of here. Hey, Jazzy. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here. Chapter 27, Jayden. It took us some time, but we finally came up with a plan to help Mimi. When I first found out about what she did, I was mad. I'd specifically said that I was going to handle the situation, but Mimi was always going to be Mimi, so she didn't listen. She actually found out where Stacy and Kaylin were, but it didn't matter because we already knew. We just didn't tell her, which was actually a bad move. She flipped, and there was no stopping her. I knew there was only one thing for me to do. Fulfill my promises and get her kids back for her as soon as possible. Today was the day that everything would be going down, and here I was with my face in my hands. I wasn't nervous or anything. I only hoped that everything would go the way we planned so that Mimi could get her kids back. I was ready for this to be over with. I wanted my girl back. The girl I met in Atlanta that day at the gas station. Not this one. The girl she was now, I don't recognize. We had to come all the way back to Atlanta to drop the girls off so that they would be safe and out of harm's way. Then we'd go back to New Orleans, where they were, and get the kids. Mark was already there scoping out the scene. If anything were to go wrong before we got there, we'd know, but hopefully everything would go smoothly. When we pulled up to the house we were staying at, I was in a zone. I had spent the whole drive back in silence. I even went as far as turning my phone off so that no one would interrupt me. Well, how the fuck are they gonna notify you that something went wrong, my guy, if you're turning off your phone? The fuck? What sense do that make? I needed my mind to be clear of everything, and it was. Turning the car off, I waited until the girls got out, then I got out behind them. Jay, can I talk to you for a minute? Troy asked, walking over to me. What's up, Ma? I asked her. I don't know what's going on between y'all right now, but you and Mimi need to get it together. She loves you, and what you're about to do tonight clearly states that you love her, but y'all gotta get it together. The shit that we're about to do can cost us all our lives. So, whatever the hell y'all feeling, some type of way, fix it, she said, and then walked into the house. I stood there thinking about what she just said. She was right. For the past few days, there had been a distance between us. Right now was the perfect time to fix it, and that was what I was about to do. I popped the trunk, removing the bag with everything that we needed for tonight, and then headed inside. I put the bag on a table and went to find Amina. I ended up finding her in the bedroom, sitting on the bed. I walked over to her and picked her up. Her eyes were red, which let me know that she was crying. What's wrong? Why are you crying? I asked as I sat down, pulling her on top of me. I don't want to fight with you anymore, Jayden. All I want is for us to be a family, and we can't do that if we hate each other, she said, looking into my eyes. Ma, I don't know where you got that shit from, but I could never hate you. Yes, we've been through a great amount of things these last few months, but I don't hate you. I actually love your little stubborn ass more than life itself, I said, putting her face between my hands and kissing her lips. I love you too, she replied, kissing me back. I'm sorry for being a brat and never listening. I promise to work on that. You good, but when I tell you that I'll handle something, I'm giving you my word, and trust me when I say that my word is bond. I keep my promises, I said to her, meaning it. I know, and again, I'm sorry, she said, then placed her lips on top of mine. Don't start nothing that you can't finish, I said, raising her off me. Oh, but I want to, she said, as she started kissing on my neck. I stopped her. We can't get into all of that like that. Mark will be here any minute, and we have to get ready. I'm gonna shower, she said, as she started to undress right in front of me. I knew what she was doing. I wasn't crazy. She thought that if she teased me, I was gonna give in, but that wasn't gonna work. I was only a few hours away from a mission, and I wasn't about to let pussy cloud my vision. All right, just meet me in the living room when you're done. I gave her a quick peck on the lips and left the room before my little head started to take over. And that's the end of that chapter. I don't even know what's the point. What is the point? But as long as we're moving along, child, we get excited about, you know, forward advancement. It's thrilling. Told you it's the little things that set me ablaze, child. Like forward movement, progress, evolution. Yes, child. Anybody got time for that other shit? Hey, pretty, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, lovey. I appreciate you. All right, so let me get... Okay, I'll get to you in a minute, y'all. Right now, I'm busy. All right. Chapter 28, Stacy. I didn't know what Kaylin called himself doing, but I hoped like hell that he knew what he was getting himself into. I got my dad to agree to let him go to Atlanta to get the money so that everything could be over and done with, but he hadn't returned yet. I'd been calling and texting his ass like crazy, but he hadn't replied to any of my calls or messages yet. Hold on, y'all. Something is going on with this thing here. Hold on. Okay. All right, there we go. I was tired and stressing the hell out. Besides, my dad was over here about to go crazy, and I didn't know how long I'd be able to buy him some time. I knew one thing, though. He needed to get his ass back to New Orleans before this crazy nigga ended up doing something that he, Kaylin, and I would regret. I sat on the sofa thinking about everything that Kaylin had put me through. Most of it was good, but the majority of the shit was bad. I mean, I played second fiddle to that chick for so long, and now that she was dead, he still barely even looked at me. Then there was my father, the man who made me, but left. I knew that my mother had put him out, but he should have been man enough to fight to be in my life. Stacy, have you talked to that no-good-ass nigga of yours yet? My father asked for what seemed like the millionth time today. He was really beginning to aggravate the hell out of me. Yeah, I lied. He said that he would be here tomorrow morning. He better be, or else shit ain't looking too good for thing one and thing two downstairs, he said, walking into the living room. Dad, please, I don't even have to be, or sorry, it don't even have to be all that. All you have to do is wait and Kaylin will be here. He's not that type of father who would just leave his child out to dry like that, I said, throwing in that last part for him. You got something you want to say to me, Stacy? Because I'm right here. You don't have to try no slang. If you want to say something, then say it, he yelled, walking over to the sofa where I was sitting. I sat there staring at him. This was my father, the first man I'd ever actually loved, and he disgusted the hell out of me. I mean, if he would want his daughter dead, then what would he do to me? Look, just be patient. Kaylin will be here, okay? I said, ignoring his little rant. Well, he better be. I'm heading out. I'll be back in a minute, he said, and then left, which made me happy as hell because I didn't think I'd be able to stand his voice another minute. Pulling my phone from my pocket, I called Kaylin's ass again, but like the 34 times before, he didn't answer. I sent him a text message. Again, he didn't answer, which pissed me off even more. I sat there hoping like hell that Kaylin got here in time to stop this bomb before it had a chance to explode. And that's the end of that chapter. I don't understand why she didn't wait for her father to go to sleep and plunge something sharp into his chest, you know, to free his spirit. Let it go free. Right, free his spirit, child. It's aching to get out. And then that way you save the children at the same time. Child, that's called doing the Lord's work. I don't understand what this goddamn gal's problem is. Hey, church lady with your bad ass. Welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. Child, they have corrupted you. They've corrupted you, but you let them corrupt you, though. You liked it. I heard you said you liked it. Yeah, you did. They told me you said you liked it. It's all right, though. I saw you back there, child. Huh. Took your doggone halo off and was spinning it around on your finger, child, just twerking and going. Had your halo in one hand and a Heineken in the other. Just egregious, child. Egregious, outrageous, blasphemous. Lord have mercy. I tried to save you. I tried to lay hands on you before you went out there, child. But you still went out there and just, Yeah, you did. Yes, you did. Don't be trying to act like you is confusion. You ain't confused at all. No, you was back there. I saw you back there just dipping it low and doing it. I know. I know. Look at your home girl telling off on you. Yes, honey. That's all right, though. Charlotte, while I was praying over the potato salad, you was out there pop locking and dropping it. Don't make no damn sense. You can pray and pray, child, but folks still got free will. Got me around here talking to the Lord on your behalf, speaking in tongues, standing in there looking out the back of the speakeasy, just talking to God. Ibaba Shundo, and you still back there just being blasphemous and bad. I know you was raised better than that, girl. But listen, it ain't nothing I can do. I did my best with you, child. I did my best. I don't know. Child, listen, that's between you and the Lord now. Go on. Yeah, Kaylin told off on you. All right, let me stop. I promise I have a good fucking time with y'all. Y'all so fucking ignorant. Oh, Lord have mercy. Oh, my God. Church lady over there feverishly typing. She talking about Kaylin. I thought we were friends. God damn it, Kathleen. Oh, my God. Oh, Lord have mercy, child. Oh, Jesus. Y'all are... Oh, my God. Child, Kaylin like, well, shit, now, wait a minute. I shouldn't have said nothing. Oh, Lord have mercy. Y'all are not going to worry me. Oh, Lord have mercy. Oh, Lord, child. Oh, Lord, Lord, have mercy, have mercy. Kayla said, I stand on it. 10 toes down. She's standing on business, minus the big ass teeth and the blonde hair. But yes, she's standing on business, child. Listen, look at her. Look at her. Talking about, I was just getting a plate of wings. Look, she can't even lie right. A plate if wings, not of, but if, right. If she catch me, I'm going to tell her I was just back here to get a plate of wings. She done mixed the whole lie up. See, that's how that Heineken do you. It lay on you real wrong. How you leaning to the side and lying. That's all right. You can't lie to the Lord, though. I hope you know that, child. You're hellbound. That's where you going. You going to hell. Sure is. You going to hell. Child, you can repent until your tongue take legs and run down the block. It could run up to the altar for the altar call, but you still going to hell. Because you had a Heineken. And a chicken wing. And you was dropping it low, boo. Lord have mercy. I don't know what to say. I can't. And then Buck was over there snapping pictures and shit. Talking about, get it. And Kaylin said, put the camera down. He said, no, this for evidence. It's okay. It's for my personal evidence book. He ain't shit. Y'all be thinking that he out there for y'all. Y'all talk about, ooh, Buck got us moist. Now, Buck got y'all asses on camera. That's what he got. And he come and show me every evening after he pack up and clean up. There you go. See what I tell you about them niggas. How they do you? But that's your boy, though. That's your man's 100 grand. Buck, like, what the fuck did I... Let me fucking tip her and tell her to shut the fuck up. She wasn't supposed to say nothing. If the bitch wanted a tip, all she had to do was ask me. She didn't have to blast me in front of everybody. Ooh, child. That's what happens when you fucking corrupt one of the Lord's angels, child. Listen. That's it. You corrupted church lady. She came in here. She was just as meek and mild. And you came over with your voice and you dropped it low a little bit. Hey, little mama, what's your name? Mm-hmm. Now look at that. Mm-hmm. Next thing you know, she back there with chicken wings and Heinekens and shit. Corrupted. Had a halo on her finger spinning it around, child. Just, oh, Lord, a mess. Mm-hmm. Thought she was going to get me in trouble with the Lord. You a lie. I got evidence. Buck talking about, nah, I be chilling. She be looking at her backyard camera trying to blame it on me. You the one that pointed the damn camera that way, sir. Wasn't it you that did the installation? You said you ain't got to pay nobody to install the cameras. Auntie, I got you. I got you. I love to speak easy. I'm doing this for family. That's what you did. Mm-hmm. Yep, that's y'all homeboy though. See? See how your homeboy do you? He got your ass back there, right? Corrupted every single one of you. Wooed you with his voice and shit. Y'all like this little accent, child. Listen, see, I know what the nigga look like. Y'all don't. The voice and the face, oh, they go together real smooth. Y'all think y'all was moist. Child, wait. He gonna get on the camera. Mm-hmm. Then you gonna be able to watch what happens live. But that's your homeboy, the one y'all trusted. And he done pointed the camera at y'all ass and took the snapshots and showed them to me every evening. Right, after y'all get through saying all y'all, good night, family. Backyard gang forever. Mm-hmm. He coming right on over there. Look here, auntie. Look at this shit. Look at your nieces. Look at them. That's what he say. And he be having lots of pictures. Right, he evidence. You know what I'm saying? Right. Mm-hmm. And he do it so he can get his number of hog ties on the list. Brought down a little bit. I be deducting a few, but he be back there and he don't know I be watching him. I don't say shit. I just add one or two or five back. Don't say nothing. But that's y'all boy. Mm-hmm. That's y'all boy. Where wifey at? Uh-huh. Where she at? That's your homeboy. Ain't that what you said? I really like that Buck. He be making some good sense. Ain't that what you said? Ain't that what she typed in the chat? Go look the shit up. On the video, you know, where Buck was making everybody's drawers moist. Mm-hmm. That's what you said. I'm just trying to tell you. Uh-huh. But y'all want to get mad at me because I know everything. Wait a minute. She said, oh, my God, on the floor. Glad I'm not driving now. Child, listen. These folks is corrupted over here, Foxy Woxy. Child, be glad you didn't let them drag you back there, child. Be glad. A whole mess. All right, let me shut my ass up and get back. Oh, Lord. Hey, Peanut. Welcome, boo. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Oh, no, he thought that's how he could get off the list, but that shit don't be working. I just told you that I'd be putting the shit back. He just don't be knowing it. He don't know what his original number was. Child, I could tell him I removed 100. He wouldn't fucking know. He would have no idea. Trust me. Mm-mm. I be putting that shit right on back, child. Let him think what he want to think. You know what I'm saying? They think they know every damn thing. Anyway, run around mansplaining shit. Mansplain how you got 75 fucking hog ties coming. Mansplain that, you know, to somebody other than me because I'm the one that wrote the number down. But anyway, go ahead on. Now you can't get no damn deductions, child. Mm-mm. I'm the police. Don't you know we can lie to y'all to get y'all to confess? Listen, Londo told you, we the police. We can do whatever the fuck we want to do, right? Y'all better go watch Training Day, child. That's how y'all know how I'm running the police station around here. I promise you, I'm not, y'all ain't going. Oh my God, who is this? No, ma'am. All right, chapter 29, Shelley. I'd been with Jade for a while, and I still didn't know what the hell her stupid ass was doing, but I was not feeling this, and I didn't want no part in it. I wasn't sure what was going on until I noticed that she was following the same car that we had seen by the gas station on our way to Louisiana. I knew her ass was up to no good when the car that she was following pulled into a driveway at a house and she parked her car a few houses down, sat there, and watched the house. I wanted to ask her crazy ass what was going on, but this was her problem, not mine. I pulled my phone out and began playing with it. I wasn't trying to see shit that didn't involve me. I just hoped like hell that nothing went wrong and she dragged me into her shit like most times because I wasn't trying to have that. We were not little anymore. I had Cam to think about. There was no way in hell I was about to get into trouble. I was gonna sit there and mind my own business. If she wanted to play Nancy Drew, that was on her. I was good. I wasn't getting out of that car for nothing and no one. And that's the end of that chapter. So that must be when they pulled up to Miss Margie's house, right? They pulled up to Miss Margie's house and this child parked down to the end of the block so she could watch. So my question is, how in the hell you jump in the car with a bitch that you already told us was crazy, okay? And you ride and go out of town with this sleep slow ass bitch. And she taking you all around and you recognize that she's following a vehicle and you don't get your ass out the car. Bitch, you better tuck and roll because this bitch probably about to get you killed. Well, she gonna kill you her goddamn self, child, because she don't like your ass. She don't seem too fond of you, Miss Mammity, ma'am, but I'm gonna mind my goddamn business, child. That's what I'm gonna do. I think I'm lying. Hey, BJ, welcome, girl. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. All right, child, listen, I'm guessing that she's going to ruin the whole fucking plan because if that boy see her, it's a wrap, right? Because she his baby mama. Lord have mercy. Just dumb. Yeah, this going to be a mess. And that's okay. All right, here we go. Chapter 30, Mimi. I wasn't trying to throw the plan off schedule, so I didn't take as long a shower as I would normally do. When I got out of the shower, Mark was already there, so I busted my ass to the room and got ready. Pulling the clothes out of the bag that Mark had gotten for us, I hurried up and threw them on, threw my hair into a ponytail, then went to meet them. When I walked in, they were already talking, but they stopped when I came in. "What's up?" I asked, taking a seat next to Jayden on the sofa. "Nothing much. We were just going over the plan again," Mark replied. "How are you feeling?" "I'm okay," I said to him. "Okay, well, you ready?" he asked. "I'm as ready as I'll ever be," I told him. "Well, let's get ready to do this," Jayden said, getting up from the sofa. He then walked over to the closet and pulled a huge duffel bag out of it. Walking back over to where he was sitting, he placed the bag on the coffee table and opened it. "Damn," I said. My eyes bucked as I saw all of the guns that were in it. He reached in and pulled out two guns. "Do you know how to handle this?" he asked as he passed them to me. "Boy, please," I said, taking the guns out of his hand. I then watched as he passed two to Troy, about three more to Mark, and then took his pick. "You guys ready?" Mark asked, getting up from the sofa. "I thought we already determined that they were ready. What is this? Fucking Sesame Street?" "Hold up. Wait a minute," I said, stopping them. "Before we go, I just want to say thanks to all of you for everything that you've done and are about to do for me. I know I haven't been the best person to get along with and that I've been hard-headed, but I appreciate everything and I'm thankful that you guys didn't leave me when I needed y'all the most." "Ma, chill out. You acting like we ain't coming back," Jayden replied. "You never know, we may not, and I just want to thank you all for everything." "You're welcome," he replied. "Now, let's go and get your kids back so we can finally move on with our lives." "I love you, baby," I said, giving him a kiss. "I love you too," he replied. And with that being said, we left out the door. Child, I hope this boy don't die because this bitch is going to be devastated, child. And I'm still not going to care because she's still dumb. We hopped into the car and were on our way to get my kids back. I was finally about to put this shit to rest once and for all. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, listen, Linda. Oh, okay. I'm trying to hurry up, child. All right, hold on, y'all. Okay, sorry. My pen ran out, so I had to scream for another one right quick. Chapter 31, Jade. I sat in the car watching Mimi's house like a hawk. I knew some shit was about to go down when dude grabbed that big-ass duffel bag out of the trunk. I wasn't a stranger. The only thing that could have been in there were guns, which confirmed what I had thought. Something was about to go down, and I was not gonna miss this. I parked my car a few houses down and waited. Not too long after that, the little light dude I'd always see Mimi with pulled up and went into the house. By that time, it was getting dark. Almost an hour later, the four of them came out like they were about to go to war. Oh, shit, I thought, as I watched them hop into the car back out of the driveway and pull off. Not wanting to be left behind, I started up the car and followed them. I didn't know where they were exactly, but I knew whom they were going for. They had no idea that I was about to fuck their whole plan up, though. See this retarded bitch? I hope they just blast them. That's the end of her channel. She's so fucking slow and dumb. Stupid whore. And then Kaylin's still gone. I hope he die. I really do, because he still ain't gonna want you. He's still gonna be with a whole other bitch. Dummy. Oh, that girl is just dumb. All right, I got the timestamp. We just gotta wait for the shit. Oh my God. I swear I may have to start pre-reading or some shit, because I can't read no more dumb bitch shit. I can't and ain't. Chapter 32, Kaylin. It didn't take any time to make it back to New Orleans. I didn't know if I was nervous or what, but I couldn't shake the funny feeling that I had in my stomach. I didn't have time to worry about it, though, because before I knew it, I was pulling up to the house where Stacy and her father held the boys. When I got out of the truck, I noticed that the whole block was extremely quiet today. Not thinking anything of it, I grabbed the bag that the money was in and made my way inside the house. When I walked inside of the house, it was dark and unusually quiet, as if there was no one at home. Yo, anybody here? I asked as I tried to find the light switch. Damn, it's about time that you showed up. I thought I was gonna have to come look for you and shit, Stacy said, flicking on the light. Well, I'm here now, ain't I? I said, taking a seat on the sofa. Your pop's here? Nah, he just stepped out. He'll be back in a minute, she replied, like it was cool. I know he got a phone or something. Call him and tell him that I'm here and I'm ready to get this shit over with. All right, she replied as she got up, grabbed her phone, and walked into the kitchen. She returned a few minutes later. He said he'll be here in a minute, she said, taking a seat on the sofa opposite me. As I sat there looking at her, I couldn't help but to think of the many ways I could make her and her father disappear. I couldn't stand to see the sight of her right now. Kaylin, where do we stand after all of this? She asked me. Honestly, Stacy, I don't know. Well, I thought you said that once this was over, we were going to be a family, she stated, sitting up. I didn't answer her. I didn't want to say too much. That could jeopardize me getting my boys back and leaving here in one piece. So you going to sit there and act like I ain't talking to you at all? Stacy, chill. Let me just get the boys and get this nigga the money and we'll go from there, I said, trying to satisfy her. Okay, she replied. I wasn't trying to have any more conversation, so I pulled my phone out of my pocket and turned it on. My phone immediately began to ring from all of the missed calls, text messages, and voicemails, which all happened to be from one person, Stacy. I looked at her, giving her a side eye before I found Shelly's number and sent her a text. I didn't have time to wait for her to reply before I heard the door open and Stacy's father, along with the boys, came walking inside. I got up, but when I noticed a woman walk in behind him, I immediately sat back down. Marie? I asked, not believing my eyes. Kaylin, she nonchalantly replied. What are you doing here? I came to collect what's due to me and mine, she said, confusing me. What the hell are you talking about? The money, Kaylin. Where is it? She answered. I couldn't believe that she was working with these snakes. How could she even do that to her own grandkids? I'm not giving anybody anything until I get my boys and know that we're getting out of here. All this time it's been you? Stacy asked, getting off the sofa. Of course it's been me. How else was Julius gonna know where Amina and the kids were? She replied. She shoved the boys down the hall into a back room and pulled the door shut. So it was never about me and Kaylin Jr. You only had me in on the plan because you knew I had Kaylin's son, she said, turning to her father. Darling, you are weak. Just like that nigga was pussy whipped, you was hung up on his dick, even when you knew that nigga wasn't gonna wife you, her father said to her. I couldn't do anything but chuckle. Here I was, thinking I was the only one who was being fucked, but it seemed that Stacy didn't know her father like she thought she knew him. So you had your own daughter killed because of her mother? What are you talking about? I asked her. Yeah, you didn't know, Marie asked. Stacy and Amina are sisters. At least, they were, Julius replied. No, they are, Marie replied, laughing. You see, Amina is actually, she started to say, but stopped when the front door came crashing down. Am I too late for the party? I heard a voice say. I froze because I knew damn well this wasn't who I thought it was. When I turned and saw Amina standing there, I thought I had seen a ghost. Hello, Kaylin. You miss me? And that's the end of her chapter, or his chapter, or whoever, child. This fucking bullshit. This dramatic ass fucking soap opera fucking Alexis Colby Carrington or Carrington Colby or whoever, child. Listen, ain't nobody got time for this Knots Landing ass bullshit. This old Santa Barbara on a Wednesday afternoon ass storyline. Get your young and the restless guiding light motherfucking all my chilling ass storyline right in ass out of here. I'm so fucking annoyed I can't get my goddamn time back. That's all right. That's all right. This is so fucking ignorant. Lord have mercy. From now on, I'm going to assume about a book whatever the worst fucking comment says. That's true. It's the truth. Fuck. You know, sat up here holding our dicks reading this bullshit, and she bust in, tell me, you miss me? And who is this fucking bitch, Marie? Why are we just now hearing about this hinhole? And all of a sudden now her funky ass got everything to do with it. Oh, buzzard back bitch. I'm so sick of this bullshit. Oh, my God. I cannot. I'm done. Oh, this is fucking... They do me dirty, y'all. Who recommended this shit? Damn. Chapter 33, Stacy's dumbass. I couldn't believe everything that was going on now. I knew my father was grimy, but I never thought that he'd fuck me over. To know that this whole time, Mimi's mother was the one who was pulling the string. Oh, that's Mimi's ugly ass mom. The fucking junkie? Oh, my God. It was the... That's her man. Did you... Wait a minute. So she done got this bitch right in the eyes of the Lord by getting her clean and buying her a fucking apartment and shit. And this is how this musty lip bitch treat her? This hoe got wizard sleeves and motherfucking roaches in her kitchen. Oh, Lord. They really didn't give a fuck that they had their own daughter killed and kidnapped her kids. I mean, where the fuck they do that at? Those two motherfuckers were made for each other. They were snakes and snakes belong together. As I stood there, trying to figure out a way to get up out of there without getting myself killed, the fucking door came crashing down. What the fuck? I thought. And as if the situation weren't already fucked up, Amina came busting through the door. At first, I thought I was dreaming, but when she spoke up, I knew damn well that this wasn't a dream. This shit was actually a reality, and I knew from that moment on things were gonna get crazy. And that's the end of that bullshit. Child, listen, Linda. Okay, we gonna keep on rolling on, because listen... I'm putting the juice to the moose. We are zooming down the goddamn... Oh, Lord. We zooming down the highway. I promise you that. Baby. Mm-mm. I swear. No, God. Oh, Lord. Mm-mm-mm. Chapter 34, Mimi. The whole time I sat in the car, all I could think about was my boys. I didn't want them to get hurt in this whole madness. I prayed that everything would go as smooth as Mark said it would be. Don't worry too much. Everything will be fine, Troy said, as if she could read my thoughts. You see, why everybody got to get a chapter to speak about it from their perspective? Because quite frankly, I don't give a fuck. Get the goddamn kids, get your goddamn ass out of there, and get the fuck on back and get all your chilling together. Take your money and go hide somewhere. That's it. I don't need 30 different fucking perspectives of the same fucking scenario. I don't give a fuck that much. Damn. Anyway, I know. I'm just ready for all of this to be over and done with, I said to her. Shit, not more ready than I am. It's about time he decided to join the party, Mark said, as we pulled up to the house. It's showtime, Jayden said, checking his guns. What in the fuck of the ride-along fucking plot is this shit? Anyway, once he was sure that everything was okay, he got out of the car. Let's go, Mark said as he got out behind him, followed by Troy and then me. Now remember what we said. If things start to go wrong, bail and we'll finish everything, Jayden said to me. I know, I replied as I held both guns in my hands. See you in a minute. The plan was for us to go through the front so that we could distract them while Jayden and Mark crept through the back. I didn't know if it was going to work, but I was not turning back now. The street was unusually quiet as Troy and I made our way toward the front of the house. Like thieves in the night, we opened the gate and walked up to the front door. Once we made it to the door, we could hear a lot of fussing going on. I'm going to count to three and we'll kick the door down, I whispered to Troy. Okay, she said, nodding her head. One, I said, as I began to count. That's usually where it starts, bitch. All right. Two, I said, just as I heard my name being called. Three, I said, as we brought our legs up and kicked the door off the hinges together. Am I too late for the party? I asked, scaring the shit out of all of them. I then turned to Kaylin, who looked as if he had seen a ghost. Hello, Kaylin. You miss me? Mimi, is that you? He asked. The one and only baby. Oh, my fucking God. Chow, I said as I walked into the living room with Troy behind me. But I thought you was dead, Stacy said. No, I can assure you both that I'm alive and well, I said to her. What's going on? Did I interrupt something? Yes, you actually did, the nigga who happened to be my father said. Well, well, well. Hello there, daddy dearest, I said, walking over to him. You don't look happy to see me, because I'm not, he had the nerve to say. Oh, I can see that. It's too bad, though, because I don't give a fuck, I said. Out of the corner of my eye, I caught Stacy trying to get up. Nah, bitch, sit right there. I wouldn't want you to miss the party, I said, pointing my gun at her. Look, Mimi, it don't have to be all of this, the bitch said, hitting a nerve. I walked over to her and hit her so hard in the face, I thought for sure that I had knocked a few teeth out of her mouth. Bitch, was you thinking like that when you came up in my house and had my nigga shoot me? I said, heated. I then turned to Kaylin, who was standing there as if he ain't had shit to worry about. And you let this bitch come between what we had. For what? To get played. I bet your dumbass had no idea that this bitch was my sister. Hell, I didn't even know until I went to visit Mommy Dearest over there, and she told me. So you knew the whole time that Mimi was alive and you didn't tell me? Julius asked Marie. Actually, I did, she said, pulling a gun from behind her back and pointed it at him, confusing the shit out of me because I thought for sure that she was working with them. You don't actually think that I would go against my daughter for you now, would you? So you wasn't working with him? I asked now, pointing the other gun that I had at her. I'm not gonna lie to you. At first I was when I thought that you were dead, but then I got hit with reality. This nigga was the reason why I was who I was. He was the reason why I did what I did to you. I didn't know that he was going to kill you. I really didn't. So when I found that out, I started to formulate a plan of my own. Then you came back into the picture, she said. I was never going to let him harm one strand of hair on Kaysen's and Kaylin's heads. I just needed him to think that I was. I stood there thinking, on one hand, we bonded, or at least I thought we had, but here she was in bed with the enemy, and that shit didn't sit well with me. I wasn't buying her story. Why the fuck did she hook up with the nigga in the first place? Talking about a plan. For all I know, this could be a part of her plan right now. I wasn't about to let her manipulate me again, so I pointed my gun and shot her in her head, killing her instantly. That's what I'm talking about. Thank you. Finally, we get what I've been looking for. Start the blasting. All right. Okay. stupid bitch, Julius yelled. Nah, she was the stupid one for thinking that she was gonna cross me, I said, pointing my gun back at him. I'm gonna ask you one time, where are my kids? Eat a dick and die, bitch, he replied. Wrong answer, I said, shooting him in the leg. Ugh, he moaned in pain. Where are my kids? I asked him again, but he didn't answer, so I shot him in his other leg. I walked over to him and pointed the gun at his face. Where the fuck are my kids? They're in the room down the hall on the left, Stacy yelled from behind me. I turned to look at her when I spotted Jayden and Mark in the hallway. Mark, take this bitch to the back and get my kids. Okay, he said, grabbing her. At first, she looked as if she didn't want to move. Bitch, if you know me, you run and get my kids from the back, I said to her. Mimi, please don't hurt him, she said, begging for her father's life. I looked at her, cracked a smile, and then shot the nigga in the head. Yes, bitch, that's what I'm talking about. Finally, you still ain't redeemed yourself, bitch, but okay. At first, I was gonna kill him while she was in the back, but I had another thought. I ain't give a fuck about the nigga, but since she did, I wanted her to watch him die. I killed him right in front of her eyes. No! She screamed, trying to get away from Mark. Bitch, I wouldn't do that if I was you, he said, placing a gun to the back of her head. Come on, let's move, he said, pushing her to the back of the house. A few minutes later, they came back into the room with Kaysen and Kaylin. Mommy, they both said, running over to me. Hey, boys, I said, hiding the guns behind my back. What you hiding them for, hell? What you hiding? They need to know. The fuck? Anyway, where have you been? I missed you, Kaysen said. I missed you all, too, I said to them. Troy, get them and take them outside. We'll meet you back at the car. No, they started to scream. Not now, boys. I need y'all to go with Auntie Troy. I'll be out in a minute, I said to them. Will Daddy be coming with us? Kaylin asked, shocking me. Yes, Daddy will be out in a minute. Now go, I said, pushing them in Troy's direction. Okay, they said as they hung their heads. I waited until Troy and the boys were out of the house before I turned back to Stacy. I was ready for all of this to be over. I walked over to her and stared at her. I thought dude just took her out back, but okay, child. All right. See, I didn't understand why you was always so jealous of me. You was my friend. Whenever I had, you had. We're practically ate off of the same plate, and yet you stabbed me in the back. Mimi, I'm sorry. My father used my feelings toward Kaylin to get me to turn on you, and I really wish that I could take it all back, she sobbed as the tears started to roll down her face. See, the first mistake that you and Kaylin made was underestimating me. The second mistake y'all made was when y'all didn't check to see that I was dead back in that house, I said, and shot her 4 times in the chest. Turning around to Kaylin, I stood there staring at him. Here was the man I'd loved for over 10 years of my life, the same man who fucked my sister and had a baby by her. He was also the same man who shot and left me for dead, and right now the only thing I felt for him was hate. I want to thank you for what you've done to me. Because of you, I finally found and know what a real man is, I began to say, but he interrupted me. Just cut all of the bullshit out, Ma, and do what you came here to do, he replied. Okay, I said, as I raised the gun and aimed it at him. Bitch, I wouldn't do that if I was you, I heard a voice say. When I turned, I was face to face with Jade, Kaylin's side piece. Damn, Kay, your bitches just don't know when to cut it, huh? Bitch, please, you should have stayed dead where you was, she replied as she took 2 steps in my direction. And if I would have stayed dead, you still wouldn't be able to have Kaylin. That is why you're here, right? It surely ain't for you, she replied. Like before, the bitch was never on point. Kill her, I said to Troy, who had snuck up behind her. She never even saw Troy coming. I heard several shots ring out, but I wasn't focusing on that. What I was more worried about was Kaylin trying to run. Raising the gun up, I let off several shots that hit him straight in the back, and then he went down. I bet he was probably wishing that he never took me to the gun range. I didn't even go over to check on him. I was more than sure I'd done what I intended to do. Let's get out of here, I said to Jayden and Mark. Hold up right quick, Mark said as he walked over to the duffel bag that was sitting by the sofa. When he opened the bag, there was an ass load of money in it. Picking up the bag, he then began to spread money around the living room, and I knew just what he was trying to do. Now we can go. No, you go shoot that nigga in the back of the head to make sure he dead, because, bitch, that's how you came back to life, like a nigga out the box. Boing, 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 because nobody shot you in the back of the dome. Y'all be thinking that the back shots be killing niggas. That shit don't always work, unless you sever the spinal cord. But for the most part, it don't always work. You got to make that nigga's head into a soup bowl from the back. It hold a lot of liquid too. Do that shit. Now I bet you this nigga gonna pop back up in 5 years or some shit, looking through the window at the happy family. Girl, don't you do that shit to me. This nigga better be dead. Oh my God, y'all. He better be dead. Oh Lord. All right. If he's dead, I'll wipe everybody's list clean. Everybody. I'll wipe everybody's list clean. Y'all better pray. Because I don't know what's going on. This is part two, child. Okay. All right. I took one last look at the bodies that were lying around the room before I followed Mark and Jayden out the door. Oh. You know what? Even if he popped back up like a nigga in the box, he's still going to jail. Because remember, he killed that girl that was pregnant by him. Remember, he choked a booger out of her ass? They looking for his ass. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, maybe y'all won't get y'all shit wiped clean. But we gonna see. Fuck y'all. I'm not wiping it clean. Y'all bad. I was very happy that everything was over and I now had my kids back. The hardest part was over. Now all I had left to do was to get my life back together. No, not necessarily, darling, because guess what, bitch? That girl's sister was sitting outside in the car, but you niggas didn't know that. So that's the little baby name from Virginia or whatever. She, what's her name? She, what you call it, baby dad, baby mama? Shelly dumbass. Mm-hmm. And look, her fucking section coming up next, child. Lord have mercy. All right, here we go. Let's see what this dumb hoe got to say. Girl, if you know like I know, you better get little on their asses. I'm talking throw that bitch in drive and irk the fuck out. Don't get caught up in that bullshit, child. Go back and mind your own fucking business. Act like you don't know a goddamn thing, because that nigga yearn, your baby daddy, he ready to blast your fucking noodles smooth up out your bowl too, bitch. You better tread lightly like a woodpecker with a headache and a bunion, bitch, because Lord have mercy. All right, here we go, child. This is insane, child. This is crazy. All right, here we go. Chapter 35, Shelley. Oh, Lord. I should have followed my first mind and left when I said I was. Now Jade's ass had me stuck in the middle of some shit. When she first got out the car, I was cool. I stayed my ass right there and minded my own fucking business. It was about a few minutes later when I started to hear plenty of gunshots that I got worried. I sat in the car scared out of my mind. I didn't know if I wanted to get out of the car and check on her or call the police. Going against my better judgment, I got out of the car anyway. Tiptoeing and looking behind me every second, I made my way toward the house that I had seen Jayden walk to. The door was off the hinges, so I was able to see straight inside. When I walked inside, there was blood and dead bodies all over the place. I spotted Jade over by the sofa, and I ran to her side. Jade, get up, I said, taking her into my arms. Get up, Jade, I kept repeating, but she didn't answer. I checked her arm to try to find a pulse, but I couldn't find any. I attempted to pick her up when I heard coughing coming toward the kitchen, so I got up and went to check. I almost lost it when I spotted Kaylin by the back door with blood all over him. Oh, my God, Kaylin, I said, rushing over to him. Help me, he said. Okay, don't talk. I'm going to get you some help, I said, as I located a phone and dialed 911. Hello, I need some help. Someone's been shot, I said, once the operator came on the phone. What's the address, ma'am? She asked. I located a piece of mail and rattled the address off to her. What's your name, ma'am? She asked. That's when everything hit me. Here I was, sitting in a house with buku dead bodies, and I had no idea what happened. Instead of answering her, I hung the phone up. I have to go, but help is on the way, Kaylin. You just have to hold on, I said, as I got up from the floor. I walked over to Jade and removed the keys from her pocket. I then gave her a kiss on her forehead and got my ass the hell up out of there. I wasn't trying to get caught up in this bullshit. There was no way I was going to go down over something I didn't do. I ran all the way down the street, hopped in the car, and pulled off. I silently said a prayer for Kaylin, wishing that the ambulance would get to him in time. And that's the end of that chapter. What I tell y'all, child? A stupid hoe. Lord have mercy. I'm just glad Jade busted ass is dead. That goddamn girl was a fucking moldy box of fucking Jiffy Mix. Crazy bastard. Lord, you know, with the fucking weebles in it and shit, them little things that be inching along like an inchworm, you know? Child, it's a video on YouTube that should have shot. I told y'all, y'all better not use that shit. Just make your goddamn cornbread from scratch like a normal motherfucker using that bullshit. Nobody want no sweet ass corn. That's why I smell the shit before I eat somebody's cornbread. But I really don't be eating folks' cornbread that often because most of these motherfuckers nasty. But anyway, let me stop talking and finish up the book. It be fucking weebles in them damn Jiffy cornbread mixing box and muffin mixing box. Y'all better look it up on YouTube. It's a video, child. I've been telling folks for years. I saw that shit, hell, in the 99s and the 2000s, child. There was like 2009 or 2010, something like that. Yeah. So y'all better stop playing using that bullshit on Thanksgiving to make your fucking dressing. Who the fuck eat that bullshit? Nobody want no sweet ass fucking dressing. That shit's nasty. Got me fucked up, child. I'm not trying to fool with that shit. Anyway, stop eating that shit, period. No. All right, here we go. Chapter 36, Mimi. I couldn't believe that everything was over and done with. I could actually breathe. I now had my kids back. We were headed back to Atlanta in a few days, and I had Jayden. Bitch, why you ain't headed back to in Atlanta today? Fuck it. What? I can't even talk. What are you staying in fucking Louisiana for? What good does that make? What sense does that make? All right. I was not going to say that the road was easy because it wasn't. I'd had some trying times, and there were a few times when I wanted to give up, but by the grace of God, I was able to hold it all together. I had a great support system in Jayden, Troy, Mark, Weedy, and Margie by my side throughout this whole ordeal. I really had to thank God for Jayden. Without that man, Lord, I didn't know where I would have been. I'd have probably been in a mental institution somewhere. It was now summertime and I was enjoying the weather, so I decided to have a barbecue and pool party. I invited my friends and the people I considered my family. I never got a chance to relax after all of the things that I'd been through these past 12 months, so I was actually enjoying this little peaceful time. From a distance, I sat there and watched as my kids, Jaden's son, Cam, and a couple of other kids from the neighborhood enjoyed themselves in the pool. As I watched Kaysen, Kaylin, Kayla, and Kayla, my heart warmed up as I noticed the smiles that were plastered on their faces. I was so happy to be back in their lives. It felt good knowing that no one could come and mess this up again. Well, except for Shelly, but keep on, child. I was finally done with the bullshit. Stacy and Julius were probably somewhere in hell together. Child, let's hope the fuck so. Because ain't nobody trying to hear from Stacy and Julius or your ignorant-ass junkie mammy. I made sure of that. Shit, I wouldn't have been surprised if they bullied the devil for his spot. As for Kaylin, he wasn't as lucky as they were. He was alive, but he was probably wishing that he weren't. I didn't blame him, though. If I were a paraplegic, I'd probably be thinking the same thing. I couldn't live my life knowing that I had to spend the rest of it in prison while being confined to a wheelchair. Ooh, child, he gonna get all kinds of violated. How you gonna fight that? Child, you better do something to get your ass in a shoe program, nigga, so you could be all by yourself. Otherwise, you just gonna be a, not a walking violation, a rolling violation. You and Governor Hot Wheels. Anyway, see, I thought about killing his ass, but death would have been too easy for his ass. I wanted that nigga to be able to live and think about all the shit that he'd done, for him to see the grass wasn't greener on the other side and how he should have never fucked with that duck ass hoe Stacy because she'd been a snake. I wanted him to live his life knowing that he had kids he wouldn't be able to see. I wanted him to see how the shit felt when they were doing the shit to me. They asked me if I felt bad for him, but I said no. Honestly, I didn't. He never felt sorry for me, so I didn't feel sorry for his ass. He deserved everything that he got, and if I had to do it all over again, I would have done it all over again. I sat deep in my thoughts, just thinking about all the shit that I'd been through in the past few years. Some things were great, as others were not so well, but still and all, I'd somehow survived every storm that was in my way. There were a lot of people who would have gone through the things that I'd gone through and given up, but not me. Hey, lady, I see you over here daydreaming and shit. You all right? Troy asked, sitting in the chair beside me. I took a minute to look around at all the people sitting in our backyard. There was a crew of people dancing. Some were in the pool, others were playing spades, and the rest were eating. When I was left to die, I never imagined that I'd be enjoying life again, and yet here I was. Actually, I'm fine. I'm still overwhelmed. Everything still doesn't feel real. I swear I thought I would spend damn near the rest of my life trying to get my life back in order from what Kaylin and Stacy had put me through. I still can't believe that everything is over. I mean, I finally get a chance to sit there and breathe, to enjoy my family, my kids, my friends, and my man in peace. I don't have to worry about looking over my shoulder or worrying about if someone is going to come and try to hurt me again. All of my enemies are gone, and I can't do nothing but thank God and you all, of course, I said to her. Girl, who you telling? That's me. I thought that this thing wasn't going to ever end. I mean, when I thought that you was dead, I was lost. Then Kaylin had taken the kids and Stacy's old dumbass was lurking around here. Not to mention all the things I went through with not being able to find your body for the funeral and Kaylin's little side pieces, Jade and Star. Huh, shit was just all the way fucked up, she said, taking a sip from her drink. One second, y'all. Okay, sorry. Yes, and fuck Governor Hot Wheels with his punk ass. Anyway, girl, who you telling? I thought for sure that I'd end up in a casket somewhere before I'd ever get to see all of my kids together again. Who you telling? We must be some cats that got 9 lives because we done used about 4 of them already, she said with a light chuckle, which in turn made me laugh also. For real, I replied. We both sat there in silence, lost in our own thoughts. You think the cops will find Julius and Stacy's bodies? She asked, looking at me. I don't know. And to be honest, I really don't care. They're right where they need to be, I said, hunching my shoulders. Besides, if they do, they don't have any proof that we were the ones who did it. So I'm good, I said, sitting back in my seat. I grabbed my drink from the table and took a few sips. The last thing on my mind was the police finding Julius and Stacy's bodies. Hell, there probably weren't any more bodies because where we threw them, I was more than sure the bugs and animals ate them all up. We didn't need to worry about the police finding anything. Yeah, you're right. On another note, what's going on with you and Weedy? I asked her. Her eyes damn near bulged out of their sockets as she swallowed hard. What you mean? She asked with this dumb look on her face. Don't play dumb with me. I know Weedy's the one ringing your phone when you claim that it's your cousin, I said, busting her bubble. You don't have to lie. It's me you're talking to. She sat there for a minute without saying anything. I know she was confused. Hell, if I were her, I'd be confused too. On one hand, she had a man who she had history with. Now, everything wasn't peaches and cream, but at the end of the day, they had a love that only they could understand. Then on the other hand, she had the total opposite. Mark and she didn't have a lot of history, but I could tell you that he genuinely loved her. I mean, what man do you know would kick it with a bitch he only met, have her back when the going gets tough, and wait patiently when it took her a while to give up the cookies? He could have been like most niggas and bounced, but he didn't, which should have let her know that it wasn't all about sex. Hell, the odds were clearly stacked in Mark's favor. Weedy'd had a history of fucking a lot of bitches, bringing home diseases and not being there when she needed them. Mark was the total opposite and the man she should clearly choose, but that was none of my business. I wasn't trying to tell her how to live her life because I'd made a lot of mistakes on my own. She should have known better and learned from my situation. If a man cheated once, he'd cheat again, no matter how much he said that he changed. Hello, I said, snapping my fingers at her. Honestly, there's nothing going on between Weedy and me. Sorry, not Meaty and we. Weedy and me, we're just friends. I'm with and in love with Mark. He's the one I want to be with. I'm not trying to mess that up, she replied. I heard what she was saying, but her actions were telling a whole different story. Okay, was all I said. I wasn't about to go there with her. As I said, that wasn't my business. It was hers. I just hoped that she knew what she was doing. Child, and don't. Just like you thought you knew what the fuck you was doing and didn't. Hence the reason why you got 3 chilling with Kaylin and 1 with Tyreek's dead ass. Yeah, your picker is broken, bitch. Right. Hey, my darlings, Margie said, walking over to where we were. She gave each of us a hug before she pulled up a chair and sat down with us. Hey, Marge, Troy and I said at the same time. How are my girls doing today? We're fine, and you? Ever since that day Margie had helped me when I was in the hospital, we'd grown extra close. She'd been like a mother to me and a grandmother to my children. She even had Cam calling her nanny. She'd been there a few times to comfort me and to check my ass when I needed it. I'm doing great. Where are my babies? She asked, referring to my kids. They're in the pool over there, I said, nodding toward the area where the pool was. She looked their way and smiled. Look at my babies. They look so happy and full of life, she said, beaming with pride. I really didn't know what my kids did to Margie, but they'd really grown on her. She was always coming over to take them to the park or bring them things. We were lucky to have her in our lives. Oh, that reminds me. There's a circus coming to town this weekend. Maybe we should take them. That would have been lovely, but Jayden and I are surprising the kids with a trip to Disney World this weekend, I said to her. Oh, that'll be so nice. The kids are going to definitely enjoy that, Margie replied. Just make sure that y'all take care of my babies and make sure that they have lots of fun. We will, and I'm pretty sure that they will. Besides, we really do need this vacation. I'm saying, Troy said, I think that's what Mark and I need. Our damn selves. Well, make it happen. I'm so used to thinking that I might not get a chance to live tomorrow that I'm living for today, and if tomorrow comes, then I'll be living for that day. Girl, I feel you. I just need a minute to enjoy my man. I second that notion, I replied, grabbing my drink and downing the rest. It had been a minute since Jayden and I did our own little thing, and the shit was long overdue. Because she put were, but how the fuck would it be were? Girl, ugh. Anyway, speaking of Jayden, I spotted him over by the barbecue grill with a drink in his hand, laughing at whatever it was that Mark was saying. Even though he had on an apron that was full of barbecue, I peeped out how sexy he was looking in a wife beater, some True Religion, and some all-white Air Max 90s. The way the sides of his lips curled up and the deep print of his dimples when he laughed drove me crazy. He must have felt me watching him because a minute later our eyes met. I wanted so desperately to kiss him, to feel him, just to be near him. So I got up and walked over to him. We held eye contact the whole time I was walking. I felt like there was no one else there but him and me. When I made it to him, I threw myself in his arms, hugging him extra tight. No words were spoken as I placed my lips on top of his, parted his lips with my tongue, and gave him one of those deep, passionate kisses. The one that says, I love you, without having to speak the words. Well, damn, y'all don't worry about the house that's behind y'all. Why don't y'all just go at it right there in the back seat? Mark said sarcastically. Shut up and mind your business, I said, punching him in his arm. Ouch! Damn, you know you can't be hitting on a nigga like that. You don't hit soft nohow, he said, playfully holding his arm as if it were really hurting him. And boy, stop playing. You know damn well that shit don't hurt. Yeah. What's up with you, though, Mom? How you doing? You feeling good or what? He asked, grabbing me and giving me a friendly hug. I'm doing fine. I now have my kids and life back, so I can't complain. That's good then, but let me holler at you for a second right quick, he said, walking away from where the guys were standing by the grill. What's up? I asked once we were out of earshot. Look, Ma, I'm only telling you this because that's your girl and all, but something is going on with Troy and your boy, he said. I wasn't surprised, though. Mark was the type of dude to observe shit. He knew shit that you thought he didn't know. Mark, right now, I don't know what's going on with Troy, but I don't think that her and Weedy are messing around, I said, lying through my teeth. I also knew that something was going on between the two of them, but I wasn't going to tell him that. What kind of friend would I be if I were to rat my girl out? Ma, come on. You can't tell me that you haven't noticed the shit that she been doing. I'm trying to give her the benefit of the doubt because I love her, but if I find out that she's fucking with him, I'm done with her ass, he said, looking me in my eyes. I wanted to say something, anything to make things right for them somehow, but I couldn't. There was nothing to say. He looked at me for a little while longer with those intense eyes that he had. For a minute, he seemed to be struck, lost in his thoughts, maybe. Then he walked off, leaving me there with my own thoughts. I turned and spotted Troy over there looking at me. She raised an eyebrow to ask me what was up. In return, I hunched my shoulders while shaking my head, indicating that I didn't know. What's wrong? Jayden asked as he wrapped his arms around me. Nothing. Why you ask that? Well, because for one, Mark came back. within, no, what? So she put, Mark came back with, in a sour mood. Was it with a sour mood or in a sour mood? Girl, whatever. Pick one. And for two, you're standing over here with a confused look on your face. So I'm guessing that something's gone down between you two, he said, staring at me. There was something about the way that he looked at me, and I knew I had to tell him the truth. He came to talk to me about something with Troy and Weedy. It didn't have anything to do with me. Well, what's going on? You know my boy is not about all them games and shit. Honestly, I asked her myself, but I really don't know. She say that it was nothing, but I'm thinking something different. Well, for her sake, I really hope that it's nothing, because Mark's a real good guy. He not about playing, and he really likes her. That shit is very rare. He don't really be about that shit. Normally, he's all work and no play, but with her is different, he replied. I heard what he was saying, and like him, I hope that the shit with Weedy and Troy was nothing, because I knew if it wasn't, shit could get real sloppy, and we didn't need no more of that in our lives. Well, I hope not then, I said, turning to kiss him. You know, if you keep on doing that, we're going to have to end this little get-together early, he said, palming my ass. He then leaned in and gave me a kiss that took my breath away. Why would you keep doing that and then keep kissing the bitch? I don't even understand it. Anyway. All right, you two, cut it out. We have guests here, Miss Carol, Jayden's mother said, interrupting us. Miss Smith, how are you? I asked, leaning in to give her a hug. I'm doing fine, and yourself? And I told you to stop calling me Miss Smith. You can call me Mom. I'm doing fine and okay, I replied. Amina, after all of the girls that Jayden has been with, I have to say that I like you. This time I can actually say that my son has finally found the right girl. I just hope he does right by you, she said, cutting her eyes at him. Ma, you don't even have to worry about all that because I plan on making her my wife one day, Jayden said, looking in my eyes. Boy, stop playing. You know damn well that you don't want me to be your wife. I was waiting for the right time to do this, but apparently there's no time like the present, he said, reaching in his pocket. Because, of course, he was fucking walking around with a goddamn ring in his pocket. You know, most of these niggas walk around with fucking engagement rings in their pockets, right? So just bust them upside the head, snatch the ring, and go pawn the shit. Like, knock it the fuck off. Oh, my God. This fool ain't even said nothing about thinking about asking that girl to marry him. Now, all of a sudden, he got the ring in the pocket. I guess Kaylin in the corner slobbering and blowing through a straw to let him know that he happy for him, too. Child, shit. He pulled out a small red velvet box and then looked back at me. I was no stranger to this move, being that Kaylin had proposed to me already. He then looked over to his mother, who in turn nodded her head in approval, and he got down on one knee, making my eyes get watery. Mimi, baby, I know that you've been through a lot of things this past year, but throughout all of this, you've survived. You're one of a kind. You're like a rare gem, and I can't let you get away. When I thought you were dead, my whole world was turned upside down. I thought for sure that I'd lost you forever, but by the grace of God, you're still here with us right now. You're a great mother and a wonderful woman who I'd like to have my own kids with someday. Child, ain't nobody having no more goddamn kids. Hell, sorry. Not to mention that Cam loves you also. Yeah, I know that we met under difficult circumstances and we haven't known each other that long, but no matter what anyone says about it, I love you, and I want to spend the rest of my life with you. So what I'm saying is, will you do me the honor of becoming my wife? By the time he was through with saying all of that, I was in full-blown tears. He was right. I'd been through a lot, and he was right there by my side. Girl, like we wasn't. Wasn't we there with you? Hell, we was praying for you when the nigga played tic-tac-toe on your back with bullets. The fuck? Sorry. He was everything that Kaylin wasn't, and I didn't have to worry about him cheating on me because he made it clear that he wasn't that type of guy. Still, I was skeptical about marrying him. Hell, who was I kidding? This was the perfect man, my man, and here he was down on one knee asking me to marry him. I'd never find another man like that, and to be honest, I wasn't planning on looking. I had my knight in shining armor, and I was sticking with him. Yes, I said, jumping into his arms, and then I gave him one sweet long kiss on his lips. Girl, your shit ought to be swollen with all the fucking bussing slob you've been doing. I love you too, baby. He picked me up, and swung me around like I was a big old kid. Yay, Mommy and Uncle Jay, my kids said, running up to us. See, that's how you fuck your kids up. Now his name, Uncle Daddy Jay. What the fuck? Or Uncle Stepdaddy Jay. Stop telling your fucking kids that the niggas they uncle, because he ain't they fucking uncle. This is crazy. Yay, Daddy and Mama Mimi, Cam said, running up behind him. Right, so he got something different to fucking say. This is crazy. Not Mama Mimi. Mama Mia. What the fuck is this? Oh, my God. Anyway. Thanks, babies, I said, bending down, giving each one of them a kiss and hug. Congratulations, baby, Miss Carol said, hugging us. Thanks, Ma, Jayden replied. Thanks, Miss Carol, I replied. You are much welcome. Oh, sorry. Listen, I'm in a fucking hurry. I left out the word very. You are very much welcome. Now that you're about to be my daughter-in-law, you can definitely call me Mom. Well, thank you, Ma, I said, just to satisfy her. Jayden, baby, I have to go, but I promise to see you later, she said to him. Don't be a stranger now, and Mimi. Remind that boy that he still has a mother, because sometimes he seems to forget that, she said, laughing. Ma, chill out. You know that ain't true. You gonna play on me like that, huh? He replied, smiling. Yeah, I bet. You be good and take care of that girl now, she said, pointing a finger at him. I will, Ma. I'll see you later. We should do lunch sometime, she said, hugging me. I'd love to. Just let me know when and where, I said, hugging her back. Okay, Jayden, come walk Mama to her car, she told him. Now, I bet you that's when Shelly gonna be out there and blast his ass. Child, listen, ain't nobody got time for this shit. Oh, Lord have mercy. All right, here we go. I'll be right back, baby, he said, giving me a quick peck on my lips. Okay, I said, kissing him back. Congrats, big head, Mark said, hugging me. You knew about this shit, didn't you? I asked him, poking him in his chest. I'm not saying that I did, and I'm not saying that I didn't, he said, laughing. Yeah, whatever, I said to him as Troy walked up. He looked at us. She then looked at him, and he walked off. Uh-oh, that's fucked up. That ain't good. Girl, what's up with that shit? I don't know. Shit, he be fucking tripping. Let me see it, girl. Quit playing, Troy said, reaching for my left hand. I held it up so she could get a good look at it. Girl is beautiful. Congratulations. She reached in and hugged me. When she tried to pull back, I pulled her closer to me so that I could whisper in her ear. Whatever the fuck is going on between you and Weedy needs to end. You have to clean that shit up and dead it today. Mark's getting suspicious, in case you ain't know or you don't give a damn. Either way, the shit needs to end. Otherwise, you gonna end up losing your man for the same man who left you high and dry, I said to her. I didn't wait for her to reply. I moved past her and made my way toward the house, leaving her there to think about what I had just said. I didn't want any part in that shit. I'd already been through too much drama already. I wasn't trying to get into this. A few people who wanted to say congratulations as I made my way inside of the house stopped me. Most of them wanted to see my ring so that they could go talk about it among themselves, but I didn't care at all. Today was one of the greatest days of my life. Bitter bitch. I was on my way to Jayden's house. I was tired of playing games with his ass. It was time that I put my fucking foot down and dealt with him and his ma. I wanted my child from over there. I wasn't about to let no bitch think that she could come in and play mommy to my child. Fuck that. I spent 13 hours in labor when I had my son, and I wasn't about to let the next bitch think that she was gonna come in and take my motherfucking spot. I'd be damned if I let that shit happen. As I was driving, I received a collect call. I already knew that it was nobody but my little boo, so I answered the phone on the first ring. You have a collect call from, the recorder started to say, but I pressed number 5 so that the call could connect faster. I ain't had time to be listening to that long-ass recording. What's up, Ma? That's once the call was connected. Hey, boo, how you doing? Child, look at this fucking shit. It's a bright and sunny day outside. Tell me why the fuck it's messing up. Because it's no we about to get rid of it, child. Oh, child. It no. Anyway. Sorry. Okay. Hey, boo. How you doing? I asked him. Lately, he hadn't been acting right. Hell, I still didn't know how he was in jail in the first place. I'm doing fine, Ma, considering the situation that I'm in. How are you? he asked in that sexy voice that I love to hear. I'm good. I'm about to go pick up my son. I thought he was staying with his daddy. Yeah, he was, but I'm about to go get him. I've missed my baby, and I'm ready for him to come back home. It's been too damn long since he's been with them. Besides, Jayden done moved his new bitch and her kids up here, and I'm not trying to have that hoe thinking that she's Cameron's mother, I said, getting pissed off. I hated Jayden's new bitch with a passion. Come on, he doing it like that? He asked me. Yeah, last time I talked to Cam over the phone, all he wanted to talk about was Mimi. At first, I thought he was talking about his grandmother until I asked him. He said he was talking about his daddy's new girlfriend. I said to him, you said her name was Mimi. Yeah, why? What's her real name? He asked, ignoring my question. I think it's Amina something. Oh, Amina Washington, I said, snapping my fingers. Why? I asked, wondering why he wanted to know what her name was. Nothing. I just thought she was somebody I knew, but I don't know her, he said. Say, I gotta go. We're about to go to chow. I'm gonna call you later. Okay, I love you, I said to him. Yeah, me too, he replied, and then hung up. I pulled the phone away from my ear and just stared at it. This nigga was just acting all depressed and shit, but now he was all jolly again and shit. Not thinking twice about it, I threw the phone on the seat just as I turned down the street where Jayden stayed. I noticed that there were a lot of cars parked up and down the street, so I was guessing that they were having some sort of party or something. Oh, well, I'ma break this shit up if this nigga don't give me my child in peace. I spotted Jayden walking up to the front door just as I was parking. I hurriedly exited the car and made my way over there before he went inside. Say, Jayden, let me holler at you right quick, I said as I walked, trying to catch up with him. Hold on, y'all. Let me wet my whistle, because I got a feeling it's about to be some shit. Oh, Lord have mercy, child. Oh, Jesus Christ. Yes, it was bodies in the house. Oh, my goodness, my goodness. Hold on. Hey, Tamika, welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. And you too, wifey. Hey, girl. Hey, I was just talking about you earlier. Hey, Nye, welcome. Let me see who else. Did I see anybody else? Nope, 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 nope. Hey, D, welcome, boo. Hey, Felicia. Hey, girl, hey. She said, I'm going to red ball it back, but let me just say this book had me to start smoking cigarettes and drinking Seagram's Extra Dry. Annoyed. Absolutely annoyed. Child, listen, I got all of y'all saying that. Okay, D, well, you red ball it on back, child. All right, let me see what else y'all saying. Child, I don't think none of this here. I don't know. Whatever I said, what you going to do about it? Nothing. Nothing. And it was probably all bad. Yes, I think I said you was the bad seed out there. Something like that. Yeah, I think that's what I said. Hey, Akira. Welcome. Oh, child. Listen. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Child, I don't know. I don't know. I think it was something like, yes, child, she's the bad seed around here. You the reason why half these folks is on the list and Buck is the other reason. All right, let me get on back to it. I'm guessing that he knew it was me because before he turned around, he blew up air in frustration. What do you want, Shelly? I came here to get my son, Jayden. I want my child to come home. Well, if that's what you came here for, you might as well get back in your car and leave because you ain't taking my son from over here, he replied, turning around to walk inside the house. Don't turn your back on me. I've played things by your rules for the past couple of months. I'm tired of the shit. It's time for you to give me my child back. You must be tripping. You know the drama that you've caused between me and you. And you bring the shit to my home. As if my girl's life wasn't already fucked up, you had to come around here and show your ass, adding extra shit to the punch, he said, snapping at me. Nigga, if you think for 1 minute that I give a fuck about your bitch, then you're wrong. I couldn't fucking care less about what that bitch was already going through. That wasn't my problem, nor was it my concern. My only concern around here is Cameron. What? His name is Cameron Jehavon Smith. Or is it just... She spells it J-A-H-A-V as in Victor, O-N as in Nancy. Jehavon. Listen. Child, I forgot. I can show you how the fuck she spelled it. I ain't never seen that. Listen, even the spell check put Jehavon. No, nigga, that's not what I asked you for. That's how she spelled it. Right there. Look at that. That's the way the baby's name is spelled. J-A-H-A-V-O-N. I done hit the wrong thing. There you go. So how the fuck you pronounce that? That's Jehavon. But I think she's trying to say Javon, child. So stupid, ghetto ass bird. All right. My only concern around here is Cameron Jehavon Smith. Oh, child, thank God that's his middle name. Anyway, bitch, I don't give a fuck what you think. All I know is that you ain't taking my child from here, and that's a bet, he said, getting in my face. I'm really trying to be civil with you right now. Don't make this shit worse than it already is, because I can guarantee you that neither you nor your bitch will like it, I said through gritted teeth. I know damn well this ain't who I think it is, I heard a voice say from behind Jayden. When he moved to the side, I came face to face with his bitch. Look, bitch, if you know like me, you'd go back inside and mind your business. This shit right here don't have nothing to do with you, I said, pointing my finger back and forth between Jayden and myself. This shit is between me and my baby daddy, so butt the fuck out of this or else you'll regret it. Look, bitch, I never whooped on your ass for the sake of my fiance because I knew no matter what, he'd have to deal with you, but I can guarantee that if you keep playing with me, I'll light your whole ass up, she said, stepping a little closer to us. Fiance? I asked, baffled. Yes, bitch, my fiance, she replied, holding out her left hand so that I could see the huge rock that was sitting on her ring finger. The minute I laid eyes on it, I lost it. Here I gave this nigga a seed, was with his sorry ass for 6 years, and he gave this hoe here a ring. Nigga, you ain't shit, I said, walking up to him. I proceeded to slap the dog shit out of him, knowing that he wasn't gonna hit me back. Child, but his bitch probably about to jump on you like a fucking spider monkey. At least that's what fuck I would have done. Hey, Destiny, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here, love. I appreciate you. All right. He wasn't the type of dude to hit on females, which was why I stayed slapping and punching on his ass because I knew he'd never hit me back. I turned around and was about to walk away when someone tapped me on my shoulders. When I turned back around, that Mimi bitch's fist connected with my mouth, drawing blood instantly. Guess what, bitch? You picked the wrong fucking day to come over here with the bullshit. You want to hit on somebody? Well, I'm about to show you how the shit feels. See, you already know that Jayden will not put his hands on you, but that ain't gonna stop me from giving you a ass whooping, she replied. I wanted to say something, but I was still in a daze. I really couldn't believe that that bitch had just hit me. Well, believe it. And that's the end of that chapter. Girl, listen. After this chapter that I'm finsta read, yes, finsta. Oh, Lord, child. And we got one more after the one I'm about to read. All right, hold on. Y'all gotta wait, y'all. I need to hit my vape. Chisaki, what are you reaching for, girl? This shit is on the other side. Listen, before y'all get to asking me if I done read this, that, and the third on the channel, do me a quick favor. Just search the shit. Type in the name of the book and then type Saki's Speakeasy after it in the search bar on the YouTube. Do that. If I've read it, it's going to come up when you type it that way. But y'all be hitting me up. Hey, did you read it? Girl, hell, I don't know. It's all the fucking things I done read is out there on the channel. I say it with love. Y'all got to y'all be Googling every fucking thing except for what you want to know. The shit you need to know, you don't Google. But the shit your nosy ass want to know, that's what you fucking Google the fuck out of. Google be like, here go this bitch again. She Googling about the neighbor down the block, but ain't Google the nigga across the street that she got three chilling with. And he got a whole harem of bitches on the west side. I'm just saying. Google be telling me all y'all business, child. Y'all just don't know it. Google will tell off on your ass at the most inopportune fucking times. Right. Child, listen. Y'all better be careful, child. Yes, it's all kinds of shit over there on the playlist. So, yes, y'all better get to looking. Now somebody finna feel some type of way. I said the shit with love. Chapter 37, Mimi. After the 1,001 congratulations that I'd gotten from the people in the backyard, I went inside in search for Jayden. When I walked into the kitchen, I didn't see him, so I went to look for him in the garage, thinking he was in there. When I heard a female voice coming from the front of the house, at first, I thought that the person was in the living room, until I got there and saw that there wasn't anyone in there. When I peeped outside of the door, I had a front row seat to the show Jayden and his baby mama Shelly were putting on. I couldn't believe that out of all the days in this year, she had picked this day to come over here with her bullshit. Today wasn't a good day, though. I wasn't in the mood to fuck a bitch up. My man had just proposed to me and I was happy. But when I stepped outside, the vibe that they were giving off was a motherfucker. I was actually going to try to calm them down, but the bitch said something that pissed me off, which ended up changing my whole mood and made me go ham on her ass. The moment she slapped Jayden in his face, the bitch had made a huge mistake. She already knew that Jayden wasn't a woman beater, which was why she slapped him in the first place. Jayden told me about the many times that they'd gotten into it and she'd hit him only because she knew he wasn't gonna hit her ass back. I was here to show that bitch something different. She wasn't about to hit my man while I was standing there and get away with it. I was about to show that hoe just how it felt to be hit on. When I punched that hoe in her mouth, she just stood there in a daze. I wasn't trying to fight that bitch like that. I wanted her to be aware of that ass whooping I was about to give her. Bitch, don't just stand there. Pick your jaw up and hit me back, I said to her. I wanted this bitch to pick up her hands and fight me fair so that I could get this hoe an ass whooping that she would never forget. Bitch, I know damn well you ain't just hit me. From the looks of that busted lip you got, you can see that I did. Ho, you done fucked up now, she said, trying to run up on me, but Jayden had stopped her. Nigga, let me go so I can whoop this bitch's ass. Shelly, go ahead about your business. I don't have time for your shit, he said, walking her to the road. I followed him. Yeah, Jayden, please let this bitch go so she can whoop my ass, I said, taunting her. Mimi, please go back inside the house. Nah, I ain't going nowhere until I whoop this whole ass. Bitch, please. The only ass that's going to be getting whooped is yours, she said, trying to break away from me. Nah, ho, you got me fucked up. I don't get my ass whooped. I do the whooping, I replied, letting this hoe know. Bitch, please, tell your nigga to let me go and I'll show you just whose ass is going to be whooped. And I can bet my last dollar that it won't be me. Bitch, please, you'll be broke because I can guarantee you that this right here ain't what you want. Jayden, please, let this hoe go. Please, I said, begging him. Mimi, baby, please just go back in the house while I handle this right quick. Please, he said, pleading with me. You know what? This hoe ain't even worth it. You got 5 minutes to get rid of this garbage before I come back out here and do it for you, I said, and then walked off. Yeah, bitch, you know better. Do what your master say and go back inside the house, she yelled from behind him. Bitch, please, unlike you, ain't no nigga got shit on me. Yes, he's my fiance, and yes, I'm about to listen to him because I don't want to have to kick your ass. But don't get that shit twisted. I'm not anyone's slave. If I wanted to leave today or tomorrow, I could because I'm a bitch who has her own shit. Unlike your needy hoe ass, I said, leaving them there. I hurried up to get inside the house because I know one thing. If this bitch said one more thing that I didn't like, I was gonna bless that hoe and Jayden wouldn't be able to stop me. When I walked out into the backyard, I frantically looked around for Mark. I spotted him over by the barbecue grill talking to the rest of the guys. I could still hear Jayden and his baby mama fussing in the front yard. The shit pissed me off even more. I stalked over to Mark as if my ass was on fire. What's going on, Mimi? Why you look so upset? He asked once I had reached him. Your boy is out front with his baby mama and he got all of 1 minute to get that bitch away from here before I go back out there and fuck him up, I said, walking away and not giving him a chance to respond. What's wrong, Mimi? Troy asked, walking up to me. I'm about to fuck Jayden's baby mama up. That's what's up, I said, walking inside the house. Mimi, slow down, Troy said, following me. I ignored her as I power walked to the front of the house. When I opened the door to walk outside, they were on the other side of the street, still arguing. I walked over to where they were and let their asses have it. I told you that you had 5 minutes to handle this situation right here, but it seems like you can't do it. So I'm here to help you, I said, nudging him in his back. Bitch, please, he ain't gonna handle shit. What you need to do is get your black ugly ass back over to the house and mind your fucking business, I heard her say. Time's up, I said to him. I turned to where she was and charged at her ass. I popped her dead in her mouth because the bitch was talking too much shit. I ain't know your ass for nothing but a minute, and here you want to come talk shit, I said, punching her in her face. Grabbing her by her hair, I pulled that bitch in the middle of the street. See, bitch, I done been through too much shit already, and here you go with more shit. I tried to let that shit slide, but you're one of those bitches who need to be taught a lesson, I said, giving her a kick to her face. I then proceeded to fuck that hoe up. I threw nothing but powerful punches at her face. With my left hand, I took and gave her two quick licks to her eye. I was trying to leave my ring imprint in her face. Ho, let me go, she said, trying to get at me, but she couldn't. You know what, bitch? Get up and fight me fair. Let me see if your bite is big as your bark, I said, letting her go. I watched as she picked herself up and then looked at me. Bitch, you done fucked with the wrong one, she said, rushing me. She gave me a good lick to my face. She then grabbed my hair and tried to pull me on the ground. I'm about to paint this concrete with your blood, ho, she said, kneeing me in my face. I had to admit that the shit did hurt, but still, the bitch couldn't fight at all. Nah, bitch, first learn how to fight before you come fucking with me, I said, giving that hoe a lick to her guts, causing her to let me go. She was bent over trying to catch her breath when I grabbed her and kicked her again. I told you that you can't fuck with a bitch like me, I said, uppercutting her ass. She grabbed a hold of me. Next thing I knew, we were on the ground. I managed to get on top of her, and that's when I blacked out. Oh, shit. Here we go. I sat on top of her chest and began to murk that face. I was trying to fuck her all the way up. When she went to look in the mirror, she was going to remember me. She was going to think twice before she ever came at me again. That's enough, Jayden said, grabbing me. Mark, get Shelly, man. Let me go, I said, trying to get away from him. Nah, Ma, that's enough. You made your point already, he said, still holding on to me. Nah, that bitch asked for that shit. Let me give her some more, I yelled, trying to go at her again. Nah, Ma, you need to chill out. Troy, come get your girl and take her into the house. I'm not a fucking child. You don't have to call nobody for me. Well, you're surely acting like one now, he said, letting me go. I was about to say something to him when I spotted Cam running toward us. Daddy, what's going on? What happened to Mommy? He asked, looking at Mark, who was helping her. Go in the house, Cam. Daddy'll be in there in a minute. He stood there, stuck. He looked at me, then to his mother, then back to his father. Now, Cam, you don't have to talk to him like that, I said, rolling my eyes at him. Come on, Cam, let's go inside, baby, I said, walking over to him. I grabbed his hand as he led the way inside the house. We headed straight for the kitchen once we were inside. Are you hungry? No, ma'am. Well, you've been in the pool all day. I didn't see you eat a thing. Are you sure that you're not hungry? I asked, turning around to face him. I'm sure, he said, getting quiet. I knew he had a lot of questions flowing through his little mind. I just hoped that he waited to ask them until his father came. Miss Mimi, he said, taking a seat on one of the bar stools. Yes, Cam. Can I ask you a question? He asked with a straight face. Sure you can, I said, walking over to where he was sitting. I then took a seat on the stool that was next to him as I waited for him to ask whatever it was that he wanted to ask. Did my mama do something wrong? Is that why you and her were fighting? He asked, catching me off guard. Well, your mother and I had gotten into an argument, and then that led to us putting our hands on each other. I simply said to him, I wasn't trying to say too much to him. This was a conversation that he should have been having with his father. No, bitch, he asked you, not his father. So he's having the conversation with the right one, ma'am. You needed to answer him just like you would have answered one of your own children had they asked you. Goofy, that's how you be a stepmother, bitch. You treat the child the same way you would treat your fucking own. Hell, goofy ass. Okay, was all he said as my kids came walking through the door. What's wrong with you? Why do you look like you just got into a fight? Were you and Jay fighting because he's making everyone leave and he told us to come inside? Kaylee asked as she and her siblings took a seat at the table. No, don't worry about that. Are you guys hungry? I asked, ignoring her questions. Yes, I'm starving, Kayla said, rubbing her belly. Me too, Kaysen replied. Me three, followed Kaylin. Y'all want some barbecue or y'all want to go and get something else? They can eat what we have here, Jayden said, entering the kitchen. He walked over to Cam and kneeled down in front of him. You okay? Yeah, Dad, I'm fine, Cam replied. You sure? Yes, he said, nodding his head. Okay, good, he said, hugging him. Let me talk to you right quick, he said, walking up to me. I placed the towel that I was holding down on the stove as I followed him. What's up? I asked once we were out of the kids' earshot. Are you okay? He asked, examining the bruise that was on my face. Yes, I'm fine, I said, removing his hand. I still was feeling salty about the way he tried to handle me earlier. What's wrong, Ma? He asked, looking concerned. Nothing. Come on, don't do this right now. Talk to me, please, he said, looking at me with pleading eyes. We'll talk about it, okay? Let me fix the kids something to eat. I'll meet you in the bedroom. Yeah, all right, he responded. He then looked as if he wanted to say something, but instead he just left. I walked back into the kitchen and started to fix the kids a plate of food. When I finished fixing and warming their food, I started to put the rest of the food in the containers. You need help with that? Troy asked, scaring the hell out of me. I turned to face her and then rolled my eyes. Girl, you scared the shit out of me, but no, I'm fine. I got it, I said, turning back to finish what I had started. You sure? She asked, walking over to me. I just told you that I got it. What's up with you? Why are you acting all strange? She folded her arm across her chest before she blew air from out of her mouth. Mimi, what happened earlier? Troy, you already know that bitch had it coming to her ass, I started to say, but she cut me off. I'm not talking about the stuff that went down between you and Shelly. I'm talking about what you and Mark was talking about earlier in the backyard before that, she asked, looking scared and confused. Oh, it was nothing, I said, as I started loading dishes into the dishwasher. When I turned back around, she was looking at me funny. Why are you looking at me like that? I asked her, trying to downplay it. You know why. I know you lying to me, she said, walking over to me. What happened? Fine. Mark knows about the shit between you and Weedy. The nigga ain't dumb. I don't know why you trying to play on him like that. Your shit is getting real sloppy and you need to clean it up, I said, walking off from her. I didn't have time to play and watch over grown-ass people. She, out of everyone else, should have known better than that. Mimi, please, she said, walking behind me. Please, nothing, Troy, I said, turning around, which made me bump straight into her. Either you clean that shit up and cast Weedy out, or you gonna lose your man. Is everything okay? Mark asked, walking in on us. I was pretty sure that he'd heard what we were just talking about. Yes, everything's fine, I said to him, but I was looking at Troy. You ready to go? Yeah, let me go get my jacket and we can leave right after, she said. I knew he wanted to say something, but instead he turned around and left the room. Mimi, you gotta help me. I don't know what to do, she said, looking at me with pleading eyes. You see, this the type of busted bitch bullshit I be talking about. Here you got a good fucking dude, and you fucking creaming for the nigga that dumped you. Fucked around on you the whole time he was with you, dumbass, and gave you all types of STDs. Stupid bitch. This is what I'm talking about. The heart wants what the heart wants. Well, your fucking heart wants a lobotomy, you bird brain bitch. Damn. Could you be any stupider? Soon as you get a nigga that treats you like he give a fuck about you, you want to go back over there to your pimp, the one that slapped you around and shit. And fucked everybody in the fucking neighborhood. On top of your dumb ass. Ugh. Anyway, child. This is fucking stupid. Now you don't know what to do. You knew what you was doing when you was laying it low and spreading it wide for a nigga named Weedy. What the fuck kind of name is that? Weedy. Anyway. Troy, honestly, there's nothing I can do. You got to figure this out on your own. The only thing I'm going to tell you, though, is to be careful, I said, walking to where the kids were sitting at the table eating. Are you guys done? Almost, Kaylee and Kayla replied. I should have known that they weren't finished. My girls were very prissy. They'd take all day eating if they could. We're done, Kaysen said, referring to him and Kaylin and Cam. All right, why don't y'all go ahead and wash up? I'll be back to clean up later. Okay, they said as they ran up the stairs. Hey, 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 stop that running now, I yelled to them. I'll be right back, girls. Okay, Mommy, they both said, at the same time making me smile. I'd waited a long time to finally be able to be happy with my kids, and it felt damn good. Walking out of the kitchen, I walked over to the front door to make sure that it was locked. Once I had confirmed that it was indeed locked, I made my way up the stairs to my bedroom. On my way to my bedroom, I stopped to check on the boys. Hey guys, what are y'all doing? We're about to take a bath, then we're going to play video games for a little while before we go to bed, Kaylin said, going through his drawer. Yup, Mama Mimi, I'm going to whoop Kaysen and Kaylin's butts in the game, Cam said, smiling. He, too, had a deep set of dimples just like his father. No, you're not. I'll be the one doing the whooping, Kaysen threw in. I stood there smiling at the three of them. We were now staying in a three-bedroom house until we found something bigger, which meant that they had to share rooms. At first, I thought that it was going to be a problem, but they quickly proved me wrong. I absolutely loved the way that they were getting along. Since day one, they'd had a great relationship as if they were blood brothers. Okay, well, I don't want you guys to stay up all night because we have somewhere to go in the morning. Yes, ma'am, they said in unison. All right, I'll be back in here later to check on y'all, I said and left. When I walked into the room, Jayden was sitting on the bed watching TV. What's up? I asked as I sat on the bed beside him. He sat up, turned the TV off, and turned to me. I just want to say that I'm sorry about earlier. I didn't mean to go off like that. I was just in a zone and I was trying to get control of everything, but I couldn't, he said sincerely. It's okay, Jayden. I'm not worrying about none of that. I just want your baby mama to know that she can't continue to come over here and do as she pleases. Her time is over. It's my time, and I want her to respect me or else shit will not be all right for her, and that's a promise. You won't have to worry about that, Mom. After that ass whooping that you gave her, I'm more than sure that she won't try no shit, he said, placing his lips over mine. Well, she better not, because I'm not gonna shit. Oh, sorry, not gonna take shit easy on her anymore. I'm not gonna shit on her easy. That's disgusting, Saki. Fuck are you reading, bitch? What in the BDSM scat play did this turn into? Anyway, okay, I got you, he said. I'm about to go check on the kids because I know you tired. Yes, I am, I said as I lay back on the bed. Lately, I've been feeling sluggish, and right now, all I wanted to do was sleep. Already told you why. I don't know why you ain't trying to hear me, he said, laughing. Boy, bye. I'm not pregnant, so I ain't even trying to hear that shit. Uh-huh. You can deny it all you want, but watch when you go to the doctor next week. Yeah, 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 I told him. Now, get out. I'm trying to get some rest. All right, I'll be back to check on you later, he said and left. I sat there thinking about my life before and how it was now. I was very happy, and if I was pregnant by Jayden, then so be it. He'd been a wonderful father to my kids, and I'd have no regrets if I was having his baby. Girl, that's three baby daddies. That's the fucking Tyreek the Dead, nigga. Fucking Governor Hot Wheels, the fucking convict. And now Jayden. Oh, Lord have mercy. Anyway, child. Yo, Mimi, Jayden said, walking back into the room. Didn't I tell you that I was tired? Why are you bothering me? I asked him, but he didn't answer me. When I looked at him, he was standing there with a duck look on his face, holding something in his hand. What's that? Again, he didn't say anything, so I got up and walked over to him. What you got in your hand? I asked, stopping in front of him. He still didn't say anything. He just stood there staring at me, so I took the shit out of his hands. What the fuck is this shit? I asked. Where the fuck did this shit come from? Ma, I have no idea. When I went downstairs, someone knocked on the door. When I opened it, there was no one there. Instead, this was sitting on the welcome mat. Well, what are we going to do about this then? I asked him. To be honest, I don't know, he said. Then walked out of the room, leaving me standing there. As I stood there with pictures of Stacy's, Julius's, and Kaylin's, and Marie's bodies in my hand, I couldn't help but to think that I was born just to go through some shit. After all I'd been through, I still found myself in some shit. I guessed I would never have my happy ending. I was still standing there when my phone chimed telling me that I had a new text message. That's the Shelly bitch, child. That's Shelly. I'm sure of it. Lord have mercy. That's why Jayden need to dead that hoe. I promise you. That's what needs to happen. But child, this ain't my book and I ain't write it. But yeah. Hold on. Let me charge my vape because I got the feeling I'm about to fucking... I'm about to fucking need it. Damn, it's 6:20 already. Make no goddamn sense, child. Anyway, Okay. Throwing the papers on the nightstand, I grabbed the phone. When I opened the message, I was confused at first, but after a minute or two, I got what she was saying. I replied to her message, then took the paper and walked out of the room. I found Jayden in his office sitting behind the desk. I walked over to him and gave him the papers. "You can trash that," I said as I walked back over to the door. "Why, we still don't know who's behind all of this," he said, getting up. "Actually, we do, but she won't be able to come for us anymore." "What are you talking about?" he asked, walking over to me. "Your baby mama," I said, and walked out of the room. This time, I had a smile on my face because I knew for sure that right this minute, no one could hurt me anymore. And that's the end of that chapter. Child, did anybody else come in here? Yeah, I saw your ass. Sure did. Yeah, honey. See, wifey missed that shit because her ass, as usual, was fucking late. Did anybody new come up in here? Who was the last one to come up in here, child? I don't know. April Showers. Girl, did I speak to you? God damn it. Child, listen. April, welcome, child, if I didn't speak to you, because I damn sure don't remember. This book got my intestines tied up in a fucking slipknot, child. I'm having a Malox moment over here. I don't know what the hell is going on. Hold on. Yes, Kaylin is Shelly's new boo. So Shelly didn't put the math together when she walked in and called the ambulance? Right. Not they brain bowling balls smooth. Right. No, Shelly didn't put it together, child. Listen. Hey, Lexi. Welcome. Thank you for being here, darling. I appreciate you. Hell yeah, he a big ass trader, child. That's what you heard, child. Your ears is working, pimping. Yep. Yeah, that's your man, $100,000. Buck. That's your homeboy. Yeah. Had your panties moist. You put him in the friend zone because, you know, y'all be in the backyard with the shenanigans. You know what I'm saying? But yeah, he was fucking... he was fucking setting all of y'all up. Just feeding you, child. Setting you up like a lamb to the slaughter, child. Took pictures and shit. Mm-hmm. Yep. And he sprinkled MSG on the rib tips if I was y'all, child. See, he do that shit to make y'all think that his food is so good. But it ain't, child. It's chock full of MSG, child. That's the shit that's addictive. But anyway, here we go. Chapter 38. Troy. Buck like, God damn it, auntie. I told your ass. We were on our way back over to Amina and Jaden's house. I'd forgotten my purse with the keys to the new house that Mark and I was staying in, so we had to drive all the way back to come in and get it. She, child, she put come in, get it. She's speaking this shit, just like they all are. So she meant come and get it, but the fucking thing here is in, not and. Because you know how black folks talk, child. We'll drop the D off some shit in a minute. Bring your ass in here and bring the rest of that food with you. Right, that part. Sounds like in. Right. So, the minute we pulled up on the block, I noticed someone creeping over to Mimi's house. At first, I was going to jump out and get him, but I made Mark park down the street and I got out. When I crept around, I noticed Jaden's baby mama walking toward her car. Silently, I made my way over there. Instead of the crazy bitch pulling off, she just sat there watching the house. I spotted Jaden as he opened the door. He looked at it, stooped down, picked something up, and then he walked back inside. "Yeah, nigga, I know what the fuck y'all did, and I'm gonna make your life a living hell," she said as she went to start the car. "No, you not, bitch," I said, pulling the blade out of my bra. "What the fuck?" she began to say, but she stopped once I placed the blade to her throat and dragged it, cutting her from ear to ear. "You should have minded your business," I said before I left. "Come on, Ma, I got the purse. We gotta go," Mark said, scaring the shit out of me. "All right," I said as I followed him back to the car. Once we got in, he pulled off. I pulled my phone out and sent Mimi a text. She texted me back within a minute. I smiled, placed my phone back into my purse, and sat back. "You okay over there?" "Yeah, I'm fine, baby. I'm just fine," I said, placing my hand over his. I reached over and kissed him. It was in that moment I vowed to myself that I was not about to let Weedy or nobody else come in and fuck our life up. We'd come too far, and this peace and happiness was what we all needed. I wasn't going to let anyone fuck that shit up. And that's the end of that chapter.
I
ought to make y'all asses wait. Oh, Lord have mercy. Jesus. Mm-hmm. Wait, what happened? What I miss? Stop talking shit about it. I'm trying to frame you, Buck. I love you. I would never frame you, goddammit. Look at my face. Does this look like the face of a bitch that will frame you? Indeed, it does. No. Oh, happy birthday, Lexi. Oh, you an Aries girl? Oh, I ain't know that. Oh, my goodness. Happy birthday. Oh, my goodness, child. Listen. He talking about we can walk to the front yard and you can see my phone too. Girl, he say that shit to the cloud, then deleted it off the device. Don't let him fool you, child. Don't let the smooth voice and the handsome face fool you. Mm-hmm. Buck's a trickster. He's a shepherd for the devil. That's who he is, child. Listen to me. I ain't gonna steer you wrong. I'm telling you now. You need to listen to me, not Buck. I know your panties get moist when he speak, but you need to listen to me, the goddamn voice of reason. Don't listen to him, girl. He's trying to fool you. Think of him as Dexter St. Jacques, child. He's a trick of the devil, I promise you, child. Listen, Lord have mercy. Yes. Well, happy birthday to you, child. Listen, she said this motherfucker is slicker than a can of oil, huh, child? Slicker than snot on a ceramic tile floor. Slicker than sperm on a whale's back, child. He's slick, okay? Fucking slipper. He is fucking slicker than black ice on Michigan Avenue in the middle of winter in Chicago. Oh, you gonna bust your ass. He that slick, child. You ain't gonna even see it. That shit look, the ground look dry. And you realize it ain't when you bust your shit. When you was walking forward, but you're looking upward, all of a sudden, it's out of your control. And take that from a bitch that's done bust her ass many a times in Chicago, baby, on black ice in the winter. You just learned that you're going to fall, child. It don't matter. You're going to hit the fucking deck. Look at him. He talking about all them eyes that was out there with me and nobody seen me with my phone. Yes, because you had on them Google glasses. That's the kind that snapped the picture. Listen, I seen the shit. It's over there on the Amazon. $49.95. That's them damn glasses, child, with the little camera on it. You was snapping it, snap, snap. You showed me how it worked. You say, see, auntie, you press the little decal on the side. Everybody think that shit say Louis Vuitton, but that's really the every time he pressed it, it's taking pictures. You ain't got to know what it is. You ain't got to know what it is. You Googled it. Right. And then you ordered it. Child, don't be trying to make me look like no damn fool. I show them the cameras of you touching your glasses to the line. Say you don't wear glasses. Y'all seen them with the glasses on. I promise you. He did that shit. Mm-hmm. Yep. Ask Don or Vince. They come in here. Where's Michael Anderson's ass at? He saw you out there too. Mm-hmm. Right. Right, child. That's what it is. Look at Peanut. Peanut mad. You gonna fuck around and make turn her into dry roasted Peanut because she is fuming hot. Right? Mm-mm-mm. She gonna dry roast her damn self. Child, let me shut the fuck up so I can read this last part of this fucking book and we can put this shit in the garbage. put this one in the can, child. Lord have mercy. Not a boiled peanut. Y'all listen, y'all thought them was shades he had on back there. The fucking shit come with the tinted visors. Yeah. Look at it. I promise y'all, yeah. He the one that did it. I'm gonna run the goddamn tape back. I ain't got to keep on taking this bullshit. Y'all seen his ass back there. Look at there go the picture of him right there. I just uploaded. See them glasses on his face? Look at the shit. That's Buck snapping pictures of y'all. Uh-huh. Right. Hey, Jason, welcome, darling. Thank you for being here. I appreciate you. Mm-hmm. Now y'all see him snapping pictures of y'all. Look at the footage. There it is. Y'all look at the goddamn footage. Mm-hmm. See, look at wifey. Uh-huh. All of y'all. Uh-huh. Right. There we go. Thank you. I'm going to exonerate my fucking self. Child, ain't no way for me to know all the goings on out there. If it wasn't for you, Buck, thank you. Thank you, Buck. I'm going to make you the captain of the fucking neighborhood and the backyard watch. Yes, indeed. You are the captain. Thank you, Buck. Epilogue, Mimi. Hey, everyone. How's it going? Well, I hope. Well, I know y'all are probably wondering how life turned out with Jayden, and I'm here to tell y'all that everything was great. He was a wonderful man and father to the kids. I'm not gonna lie. At first, shit wasn't all that gravy. We used to fuss and fight like no other, but don't get it twisted. He never once put his hands on me. He was a real man, one that Kaylin wished he could have been. I'm not gonna front on y'all, though. There was a few times when I wanted to pack my shit up and leave, but I didn't, because every time I tried to, I remembered everything we went through, and it was a lot. Too much to just try to throw everything away. Besides, that nigga was in love with my ass. He wasn't trying to let me go, no matter how many times I packed my bags and threatened to leave. He'd be like, Mimi, we in this shit together. I don't care how mad any of us gets, we ain't gonna leave one another. If I get mad or you get mad at me, we gonna talk this shit out. We ain't come this far to leave and go be with somebody else. So, yup, that nigga was everything I needed and then some. Child, listen, and there's a break. How the fuck you incorporate a goddamn break in the middle of the fucking epilogue, child? It's the end, girl. Just wrap it up real cute. Put a fucking bow on the shit and let us go home. All right, anyway. That's how you look through the night vision camera, nigga. Don't get it twisted. Everybody look light skin with the night vision camera. Playboy, that's that infrared. See, you don't know nothing about that. Watch out there now. I got that newfangled shit. At the Speakeasy. You got me fucked up. Child, that was you. Child, listen. Mm-mm. Nope. Yeah, she knew I was tired, but still. I'm gonna finish this shit. Here we go. He was outside in the backyard, girl. The cameras is outside. They outside back there. Go on now. Don't you get caught up, little mama. Babe, you ready to go? He asked, walking in on me. Yeah, let me send an email to Ambria right fast. I'll meet you downstairs in a minute, I said, looking up from the computer. Hurry up. You know the movers will be here soon, and we got to get going before we be stuck in traffic, he said, standing behind me. All right, boo, I'm almost done, I said, reaching up and giving him a passionate kiss. Child, listen. Listen to me. Don't you fucking turn off all of the bullshit before you leave and move out. So how's she sending a fucking email that she need to sit down for? If she's sending it on her phone, she could be in the goddamn car, but whatever. Don't start no shit, ma, he said, pulling back. I'm not. I'll save that shit for when we get to our new house, I said, laughing. Uh-huh. Keep playing and watch me put one in you. It's too late for that, nigga, I said, rubbing my growing belly. Yeah, he said, bending over and kissing my baby bump. I can't wait to meet my princess. I can't wait to get her active ass up out of me, I said, faking as if I was mad. She been giving my ass the blues lately. You better leave my baby alone, he said, beaming with pride. She gonna be feisty, just like her mama. Daddy, the movers are here, Cam said from the door. Okay, I'll be right down, he said to him. Okay, he replied and left. Hurry up, before you make us late, he said, heading for the door, and tell Ambria I said what's up with her fine ass. Boy, bye, I can tell you that girl is not checking for you, I said, laughing. She already got a man. Who, that nigga Donovan? He asked, turning around. Yes, and he's so fucking cute. Me and her might have to trade niggas, I joked. Yeah, don't get yourself fucked up, he said seriously. Tell little sis, the minute that nigga act up, she know how to reach me. I'm pretty sure that she can handle her own, but I'll tell her, I said, laughing. I didn't know how they became so close, but their relationship was so strong, you'd think that they were actually brother and sister. Yeah. I'm still gonna have her back, just in case. Now, hurry the hell up before I have that nigga Donovan coming to pick your ass up. Well, in that case, I'll take my time then. You already know that it's what it's hitting for, Mimi, was all he said before he left. Well, y'all, it's about time that I get myself up on out of here. I'm hungry, and this little girl is in here kicking the hell out of my stomach. Oh, her name is Jakayla. She's due this fall, and I can't wait to meet her little ass. I hope that she won't be as bad as her brothers and sisters. Her father is more excited than I am. He's finally getting his first and last princess because I'm tying my tubes after this baby. I'm not trying to be like that lady on 19 kids and counting. All them damn kids ain't what I'm trying to do. Mimi, Jayden yelled. I'm coming, I said, getting up from the chair. Well, I hope y'all enjoyed my story, and I thank you, Ambria, for helping me share the shit. Love you, sissy. Until next time, I'll see y'all later. At least I hope there won't be a next time. Amina, Jayden yelled again. This nigga was really starting to work my nerves again. He knew that shit wasn't good for the baby. Anyway, see y'all baddies and hood niggas later. I'm Amina. Don't forget the name either. Peace. All right, child. Well, she tried to end it with a little funny one-y. Huh? Oh, sorry, y'all. I don't know what he's screaming up there, but I'm not trying to hear that shit. Anyway. So yeah, child. That's it. Because, ooh, child, honey. Mm-mm. This one was a lot. Ooh, doggy, this one was a lot. A lot. Okay, hold on. Let me make sure. So I gotta hit the fucking you dig in order to What is that? Oh, I didn't know what that was. Okay. Sorry, hell. Making all that goddamn noise. Sorry, y'all. Oh, Lord, child. Listen. All right. So I'm trying to hit the randomizer and, let me see. What's today? Wednesday, right? Hump day. All right, what I miss? All right, Kaylin, because that's exactly what it was looking like. Mm-hmm. Child, listen. She tell me they're supposed to be. Oh, Lord have mercy, child, listen. I think, child, listen, that shit was a trip, that fucking Freak Nick documentary. Baby, I was looking. Ooh, I wasn't worried about it, though. Hell, I'm grown. Let me see. All right, y'all. I think, do y'all know? Not November hit him with the must be your ass because it ain't your face, Lord. All right, let me see. Okay, y'all, this, this thing got 8 books in it, child. Girl, you is a fucking, yeah, that ain't gonna work. I'm trying to see if, because everything that's coming up, y'all,
I don't want to, it's trying to come up with some other shit. Let me see. Oh, I don't know about this one. Okay, so, oh, I forgot to take that one off, child. Whoops. Bye-bye. All right. Y'all ain't bit more paying attention to meeting a man on the moon. All right, so now, I don't know what y'all know about these Kasem brothers, but this thing, I done tried to hit this thing, and it come up three times, and I think this one, because this one been up here for a minute. Like, it's a bunch of shit, too. Okay, this thing is a faux pas thing. I'm not fucking with that. I don't know what this is. Y'all just don't know. I keep on hitting it, hitting it, hitting it. Okay, so this one came up. I don't know though. Long as ain't like that pastors eat pussy too book, child. Listen. Because ain't nobody trying to hear that shit. Hold on. All right, let me see if I can get the synopsis for this one. Hold on. It's called From a Pastor to a Plug by, what's this little baby name? Shit. Patrice. Where the fuck? I can't even see the lady name. Can you please fucking knock it off? There we go. All right. Her name is Patrice Ballark. And it says, not only are they cousins, but Diva McCoy and Italy Davis are best friends too, along with another shared best friend, Kenesha. Growing up in the city of Chicago, the cousins were ruled by a strict upbringing by their religious parents. Now that they're grown, the cousins are living life a little different than their childhood. Or are they really? Diva, a little more conservative than her besties, is married to a future pastor and on the verge of becoming her own version of the first lady. To the outside world, Diva and AJ are living in a perfect paradise. But behind closed doors, that couldn't be further from the truth. When an argument ensues, Diva discovers that her husband is wearing a two-faced mask and the real small Shady shows up. Not the real small Shady. The gist of everything boils over when she unearths a game-changing secret that creates a crater-sized hole in her marriage. As she's tackling her ordeal, she realizes how her support system is not so tight and can only lean on a select few. Will Diva be able to overcome the challenges that her marriage presents? Italy. The most carefree of the band of friends, with pressure from her parents to find a husband and having some kids, Italy is nowhere near ready for all of that, especially since that doesn't equate to her truth. But is it really her truth? On the flip side, Italy receives an ultimatum from her best friend about the reality of their relationship. When she doesn't conform to the pressure and starts doing her own thing, Italy finds herself in a volatile situation that she doesn't take seriously. Unfortunately, Italy painfully learns all too late why she should have taken the warnings more severely. In this first oh, shit. What? Man. Come on, fam. Hold on. I thought that this was, I don't know if I want no extra fucking, hell no. Damn, just when I was about to say, okay, y'all, this might be the one. Oh, man. Oh.
Hold on. Let me just hold on. In this first installment of this mind-bending African-American urban fiction saga, everything is not what it seems. Secrets are more twisted than a game of Twister. Betrayal hits harder than a sumo wrestler. And love appears to get lost worse than traveling through a maze. Check out how Diva and Italy use their life's GPS to navigate the curves and bends of love, marriage, and relationships. I don't know about this shit. I don't know. I don't know, y'all. What do y'all think about that little bit? Not a one-nighter with some heavy meat. Mel. Melly Mel. Oh, Lord. Okay, so what do y'all think about that one? Okay, so if not that one, then... I think keep on... It's every time I fucking hit the randomizer... Girl, I know I'm not... I don't know about this one. Okay, so I keep hitting it again. Girl, Jay. I just popped up and looked at that and so I Oh, I think. Okay, so that's three of them. I don't want that one. Okay, so this one. I know we didn't read that book by that child. I remember I told y'all before I wanted to read that book, Booed Up with a Hood Millionaire by Shari B. And then we had the other book. I forgot what that other book was by her. Damn, I can't remember the name of it. Because everything else is coming up with two fucking... two or three parts, and I don't want no motherfucking, I needed just a fucking quick little skippity-pap. Let me hit it again. Okay, let me see. I don't even know, y'all. Like, everything, let me just try to fucking get on down to the bottom here. Okay. See, I can take a break in the middle of these. All right. So this one is, I mean, hold on. Okay, it's called the Alphabet Club. Okay, it's five books, but we can fuck around in between. You know what I'm saying? Nah, I'm not fucking with no more shorts. Y'all made me feel like shit when I read the last shorts. Go to hell, ma'am. Nope, nope, nope. All right, so let me give you this synopsis on this one. Okay, it says, the Alphabet Club, the place where alphas come to place bets and club. It's the ultimate player's paradise, featuring 26 exotic dancers named for each letter of the alphabet. welcome to the stage, Apricot. What better palace, or sorry, place? Where's my reading glasses at? Because these letters literally shit on this thing. Sorry. What better place than the ABC to hide from her abusive ex-husband? With the money she's earning, she'll be able to disappear permanently before he catches up to her and makes good on all his promises. Everything's going according to plan until Mateo waltzes in and hands her his gold card. Now she has to decide if she can trust him enough to keep her safe. But can he? Oh, child. Oh, it's an insta-love erotic novella. So it's a little short one. Now see, so hush up, Jay Peanut. Oh, that was Buck making fun of him? Well, whoever, okay? Mr. Spectacles back there. All right, so I think this one will be a cute, quick little skippity-pap, y'all, for us to dive in. As a matter of fact, we might be, because it says an hour and 15 minutes. It's only 103 pages, right? Yes, Apricot Shakara. What we're not going to be doing is shaming stripper bitches. I told y'all, I am pro-sex worker. I try to make it rain on them hoes. I really do. And I don't even mean to call them hoes. I like them. You know, they just working, trying to make their little money. Hell, no different than the bitch flipping burgers in the back of McDonald's or the hoe that make that raggedy ass, burn up ass Starbucks coffee that y'all supposed to be fucking boycotting, but keep on buying every goddamn day. On your way to work. She talking about Mr. Monocle head ass. I am... I can't stand Jay. I'ma peel her little ass like a banana. I swear, that girl is fucking crazy. Oh my God. Listen, I know I like her name too. I do. I do. Yes, that's right. Buy Dunkin', damn it. Or make your shit at home. But not that burn up ass Starbucks though. All right. So, yeah. So this is going to be cute. It's short, sweet, and to the point. All right. So, this author's from Arkansas, honey. All right. Well, bless you, child. Mm-hmm. All right, Camille. That's her name, Camille. K-I-M-I-L-L-E. All right. So, yeah, y'all, this is going to be short, sweet, and to the point, child. Mm-hmm. Yep, I think we can do this one. And then, because it's so short, right? Can you read it for Lexi? And whose birthday? Who else's birthday is it? She said, Akira said, I don't like no skippity paps. I like to listen to you long time. Oh my God, child, listen, when that fucking me so horny shit come out, and motherfuckers all the time, hey, Sanky, me love you long time. Ain't that how you say it with your little ass eyes? Me love you long time. I know, no, motherfucker. But yeah, okay, anyway. Who else's birthday is it though? Yours is tomorrow, right? So we gonna read it tomorrow. That's what I said. We gonna read it tomorrow. Child, listen. Yes, tomorrow, tomorrow, tomorrow. So one for you and one for Apricot. One for you and one for Lexi. Now watch Lexi not come over here tomorrow. Well, that'll be on her if she don't come over here tomorrow. But hell, I done gave y'all all I'm gonna give you today. Y'all done got 3 hours out of me. No God. Mm-mm. All right, so I'll show y'all too. Show you. What the fuck? I can't show you shit. But what I can do is, okay, so since this one, part two, is a little only 86 pages, child. No, Melly Mel, you're goddamn lying. You ain't thought I said tonight. Look at Buck still over here defending himself. Child, listen. Oh Lord, Buck, stop defending yourself. Buck, you ain't got to. This is not a court of law, baby. Ain't nobody got a heaven or hell to put you in. All right, so now, welcome to the stage, Blackberry. Blackberry starts with the letter B. She treats the poll like a long-lost lover, and she's more than satisfied with the results. The money is good and life is great. Is it any wonder that she's shocked to find her regular gold card is seeking more? But is she ready for that? And more importantly, is he? This is another one. So listen, some guy named Gold Card, he's her regular. I want to know what the fuck he's seeking. Child. Oh, yeah, Shakara? See, y'all be thinking that I ain't got the gang against you. They still love your ass. You come up here, I drop the link. You come up here and talk everybody's panties creamy, and you'll be out the doghouse in no time. Oh, Lord have mercy. Child, listen. Yes, I do. I used to have 3 blackberries. I used to love blackberries. Matter of fact, I got some blackberries in the refrigerator too, but I'm talking about the phone though. Yeah. He said, however, I'm all for pamphlets about strippers, but it's a true story though. Wait, what? I don't know if this is a true story or not, child. I don't think so. No, this one I don't think is a... I don't think this is a true story, child. I hope not. But whatever. So anyway, we'll do A and B tomorrow. All right? Now we love you a long time, Buck. Indeed. Yes, indeed, honey. That's why I like my niggas to look like soot. It's just blurple. All right. So now, there we have it, y'all. Okay? We have our agenda for tomorrow. Okay? So I am about to get on up out of here, child. Because I told y'all I want to watch that documentary. Yeah. I'm about to watch that right now. All right? So... that's that. Thank you, Love Jones, for all of your hard work. Let me thank you now before I damn forget. Thank you, Lila Tita. All right. Thank each and every one of you for coming over here listening to me read out loud. I hope I left you feeling better than you were when you got here. Kaylin, don't do that. Just go on over there where you're supposed to be at. All right? That part. All right. So listen, y'all have a good night, okay? And if you do nothing else, please salute your spirit and protect your peace. Until next time, bye, y'all. I saw it, L Boogie. I did. I saw it. Yes, indeed. I'm sorry you had a shitty day, Jay. I'm sorry, Peanut. All right. I love y'all. Bye. Good night.